Everybody loves Don and Mike.
The Don and Mike Show.
You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
Here they go.
No.
Now, where were these guys in the parking lot when I knew them about 90 minutes ago?
The true story.
I don't know where they were.
The Nazi has one true enemy. Himself. A man of faith. A man of hate. And a soul torn apart. New expression advised.
Rob, be right.
And good afternoon, Mr. and Mrs. New Jingles and all the ships at sea. Hey, Deuce in doo-doo.
Yes.
They are feeling groovy. Don Geronimo. Michael Mann.
Yeah. It is great today. Hello. Thank you, Rob. And hi, thank you for listening, everybody. Don and Mike Show. A new episode on this Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Hey, Buzz doesn't know we're on the air.
Buzz doesn't know we're on the air yet.
Right.
Sorry, Spuddy. Should we shut everything down?
Yep. Don't do... Just keep...
We just got to make sure that the alarm doesn't go off.
Hi there. He's just figured it out.
I think it's good.
He's just figured it out.
Hi.
How you doing?
How are you?
Hi, Don and Mike.
How's Burbank here?
No, you missed your spot.
Oh. How's your focus?
I'd say it's unfocused.
We start the show at 3 now.
Buzz, yeah.
I'm going to have to fix this watch.
You missed your spot. We were up to this part.
Yeah.
But we'd gone past that. And I was ready for you to say your...
Time flies. The hi, Don and Mike, Buzz Burbank here.
Yeah. But Mike was right there with the 2Z.
Yeah. I miss that sometimes. You've seen me do that before.
Yes. Yeah. I just flat didn't have the radio on.
I didn't even mention 127.04.
What's that?
That's the date.
Yes.
And
I should have known that.
I am so sorry.
Here is our phone number. And you're right in the next room.
Yeah, I'm here.
You're right in the next room.
Who can blame him? Today, it's havoc around here.
Phone number 877-365-3636 from anywhere in America. From Canada, 800-636-1067, Washington, D.C. on WJFK. Call 202-432-1067. We accept your calls if they're exotic, exciting. If you're talking about what we're talking about, that's great. Otherwise, just shut your pie hole and wait until the rotating random phones can.
Right.
So, yeah, having said that, yeah, go ahead. Give us a call. Not only the weather, Mike, great, great, great pre-show happening occurrence for me.
Mm-hmm.
And Buzz was a witness. Mm-hmm. And Buzz, you're going to appreciate this even more.
Probably.
After you find out who the guy was.
Ah.
So I pulled into work at the same time as Buzz.
Right.
Now. It's snowing and sleeting and it's icy.
Very icy.
It's not really an ice storm that we're having here in
D.C. Yeah, but it's just plain miserable.
And parking spots, but because they've plowed the parking garage, the upstairs part, the parking spaces are at a minimum.
Right.
So it really pays to have a spot.
Yeah.
A reserve spot.
That's
in your contract.
I'm very thankful for that.
And we've been through this a million times, and it's painted real big on the entrance to all of the tiny spots, which are really not big enough to get your car into.
Right.
But it says, reserved WJFK or reserved for the title company that we share the building with.
Right.
Well, I pull in, and of course, naturally, there's a guy in my spot. Now, the spot right next to me is Mike.
Right.
And what we normally do is park the guy in so that he can't leave.
It works best for me because you get here before I do. And normally, if a guy is in my space, I can park in front of you and park in front of him. And I just go upstairs. I don't report him to anybody. I don't know. I wait for them to find me. Let him go through the hassle.
Well, the deal is that the guy has got a parking spot in front of him that he can just pull out of if I pulled behind him.
Right.
And the spot in front of him is not big enough for me to get my vehicle into. I've already tried to just take the other parking spot. It didn't work.
You did the maneuvers.
So I'm sitting there, and I ended up kind of parking him in halfway, blocking your spot, Mike. But
after the drive today, because it's not the easiest of drives today.
Yeah.
It's kind of a pain in the ass.
Just as I was reaching for my cell phone to call somebody in the building to say, please have this guy move his car, Buzz said, I just called for you.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, well, fantastic. Well, as long as we're waiting, why don't we, talk about the news today? Because Buzz and I always have a meeting about his news show. So we had our little meeting, and the guy came down,
mm-hmm.
And the guy, and it's a nice car that the guy's driving. It's a nice German car.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the guy comes down and he says,
"Very nice."
Yeah, probably the German car.
Right.
The guy says, and this is his opening line as he walks down. I'm just standing there waiting with Buzz, mm-hmm. and I don't have him parked in or anything anymore. I'm in the fire lane. He says, "Well, excuse me, I didn't realize I was in a celebrity's spot."
That's what he said.
A-ho! And I said, "I beg to differ, not a celebrity, just someone who has worked in this sweatshop for 13 years, and after 13 years realizes that a reserved parking spot is a perk, especially on a day like today."
Mm-hmm.
He said, "Oh, that's fine, no problem."
Mm-hmm.
He gets into his car, and he says, as he's shutting the door, "I'll just pull into the spot next to this one."
Right.
Now, that's your spot.
Mm-hmm.
And again, right behind it, I mean, as you pull into the parking lot, mm-hmm. you see these giant painted letters on the asphalt saying reserved.
Right. Right. I said okay.
So I knock on the guy's window, right?
You did not.
No, I didn't. I did. I give him one of these.
We all share that camaraderie. Yeah,
that's true.
I give him one, you know, "Hey, yo." And the window comes down. I say, "Right. You can't park in this one either."
Mm-hmm.
The guy that I work with, he same thing. 13 years, it's his spot.
Yeah.
So then the guy says, "Where is Cameron's spot?" That's Cameron's the program director.
Oh, so he's doing business with the radio station.
Yeah, apparently. Hold on. Yeah.
Not with the title company.
So I say to this guy, I say, "I don't know what spot Cameron's is. All I know is that this one and the one you're trying to pull into right now are reserved, and it says so right behind the car, right behind where you park the car. It's that you can't miss it when you're pulling in. Both these spots are reserved. I don't know where you can park."
Mm-hmm.
And the guy said, "Okay," and he parked his car up on the upper level. And then as he was coming back down, he said, "Oh, celebrity spot." And
what a dick.
I didn't say anything. I just said, and then he said something like, "I guess after 13 years, you really managed to back that vehicle into the spot, you know, that I was doing a nice job of backing the car up."
And was he throwing out an olive branch, or was he still being a hump?
I think he was being a hump. So,
did we ever find out who he
hold
was?
Hold on. This is the best part.
Okay, good. I'm glad there's the best part.
So I get here, and I sit down in the office of Charles Broyhill, our producer, and I say, "What's happening?" And we start going through the stuff, and he says, blah, blah, and I say, blah, blah, and I say, "Boy, I almost called you. There was some dick that was parked in my spot and said this thing about, oh, didn't mean to be in the celebrity spot." And I said, "But he came back, when he came down to move, he asked for Cameron's spot, so he must know something about how this building is.
Right, right.
And he said, "Oh, I know who that is. That guy's name is Wes Spencer." And I said, who the F is he? He said, he's way up there. He's
he's a muckety muck.
He's like the top."
That is great.
The top chief financial officer, something like that, of this entire company. And to him, I still say, "You're an ass." it says reserve.
He's like the Uber business manager for Infinity.
Is he really?
Yeah. Yes, he is.
Oh, my God. He's a muckety-muck.
He is.
Apparently.
And
well, hi to Wes Spencer.
Here is Joe.
Hi, Joe.
Perhaps he doesn't know any better, but there is a game that people in this building like to play called Let's Park in Don and Mike and Buzz's space until 12:59. And so we either go to lunch or come back from lunch.
Mm-hmm.
But let's stay there as long as possible, because, boy, do we look cool when we park in the front lane.
Why do they do that?
Well, I mean, there convenient. Are lots of... It's gone on for 13 years.
They're envious of our parking spot.
But, you know, our parking spots are not the cherry parking spots. Those are the owners of the building. They don't suck.
I think
they don't suck.
It's the equivalent of standing 1 foot away from school property and smoking cigarettes. Or in the case of Teresa, it's a good case of, "Look at me, 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 me."
You know, you
Rob,
what?
This is your own private Teresa thing.
Yeah.
You've got going. No, I'm with Rob. 1,000%.
You hate
the
Teresa.
The greatest moment of 2004 thus far is watching Teresa get caught by Michael Hughes when she was parked in his spot.
There
it
you
felt
go.
Like dancing it was.
She's maintaining the great tradition that was established by Bretta.
That's right.
Who used to work here. And would routinely
right.
feel.
Lady Slim Jim.
And followed by, I believe, Michelle Combs is a close third in that race.
Keyhole.
As far as, yes. Mm-hmm. But doesn't Michelle have a parking space?
I'm not sure.
I think
no,
so, but
she
I don't
does,
know.
She does not.
She does not.
But now I'm letting go with all of the code names that we have for all these people.
Yes.
Keyhole and Lady Slim Jim.
And you know who really sort of pioneered the path?
Who was that?
Was Andrew Rice.
Yes, Andrew Rice.
He
yes,
was
of course.
Slimy.
Yes, of course. Yeah.
Andrew Rice, who, like Larry David,
yes.
enjoys peeing sitting down.
Well, we understand, yes. Yeah. Is Andrew Rice still working here? Is he back yet?
He's not back for 04.
Oh, he will be, yeah. Okay.
This is a guy who's left the station like 5 and 6 times.
Early in the year.
He's always left for better jobs like working
so you didn't
at Blockbuster Video.
You didn't rave out at this guy then, huh? So that worked out rather well that you didn't rave out.
I didn't call him an ass.
I would have raved out at him.
I was pissed at him. I mean, I had a tone to my voice, you know, that eventually just said, hey dude,
right?
It says reserved, and it's not because I'm what you call a celebrity. It's because I've worked here for 13 years. Ass?
Yeah, you were firm but fair, I thought.
Thank you, boss.
I thought it was a measured tone. So we should we look for some sort of accounting errors coming up in the paychecks in the weeks ahead?
Always.
You don't have to look.
I've just been handed a note that he is at extension 826.
Let's call him.
This just in, Andrew Rice now working at the CIA.
No.
Yes.
Really?
Yeah.
Terrifying.
No way.
He's a bad man.
He's got to be like a janitor or something. It can't be a real job.
Hi, CIA. Can I help you?
Yeah. How does a guy go from Morgan?
With Shrek, I'll be unavailable.
Wrong number.
No, I think he's at Shrek's desk.
Oh, Shrek.
Yeah, the big green guy.
Why don't we find this guy? I'd like to see him. I'd love to eyeball him. Can't we go? Can't we take it further on a gray day like this?
Please, Mike. We can, but we've got other stuff to get to.
I know we do.
I don't know if someone finds where he is. You know, bring me the number. We'll call
What's
him
his
up.
His name's Sam Shepard.
His name is Wes.
Wes Shepard.
Wes Spencer.
Spencer. Yeah.
Wes Spencer.
Spencer for high.
Wes.
Is his name? That's the name of a great presidential candidate, too. That's just a little primary humor, you know, with it being on my mind, kind of a make-or-break day.
Gotcha. Well, you know, don't stop believing, Mike.
Yeah, Don pointed out Wesley Clark's favorite song, a Journey song.
And it's also coincidentally the song that he's playing in all of his arenas when he goes to make his speaking engagements.
Right.
Like, remember how Bill Clinton played
Don't Stop?
Mac? Right, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Don't stop! Don't quit! joining us now, is this the guy?
I don't know. It could be.
Well, why'd you come to the microphone?
I was just going
to
tell Mike maybe you could hook his candidate up with Ross Valerie.
Yes. Yes, very exciting.
Hello.
We should.
Hello.
Hello. If he's still here... or finished with lunch. Last I saw him, that is the office he was using, the one you called.
Oh, 826?
Okay.
Yeah. Well,
right.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Right,
thank you. Here he is. Super producer Charlie Broyhill on the phone.
Thank you, but that information is totally useless.
We've certainly had every opportunity in the world to bring this out, and I should have right there. Let me just call him back. That's 467. To debut something here.
Uh-huh.
I'm going to be very careful not to abuse.
Right.
Stinky Poon.
Oh, Stinky Poon. Who is this, please? What is your name?
Wes.
Joe, you idiot. Just say your name.
It's Joe Ardinger.
Joe Ardinger. Joe Ardinger.
Nice out there, everybody. It's coming down real...
Anybody
else?
All right, Joe. Okay, bye.
Okay, Joe.
Yeah. Everybody
gets to keep Joe on the line, have him play catch up for the rest of the bit, but yeah.
Everybody gets a jingle. I'm a jingle junkie. I love jingles.
Oh, I'm a jingle junkie.
I cut my teeth at Top 40 Radio. I love Top 40 Radio. I love Top 40 jingles. We play jingles on our show the whole time that we've been working together. We played jingles when they weren't cool, then when they were cool, and now they're not cool again.
They're not cool again, which makes them even cooler.
But yeah. And I've had this argument with these dumb radio executives. I'm not going to mention anyone in particular, but the name Michael Hughes just came to me.
Yeah.
That it's
he's stealing anybody's parking spot? Oh, he's got one.
That jingles are a very good way of getting people to remember something. Like, for instance, how did you learn your ABCs? Well, you sang
right.
that stupid song.
That's right.
And everybody knows jingles, and for some reason they're not cool anymore, but... You know, we use this one all the time on the show.
The Don and Mike Show.
Right, it's like a little, it's a little happy song, let you know that, right. that our show is on.
Right.
And then we got some other ones that we played just when we were in our local breaks on WJFK, like these. Those don't air on the network. That just runs on the local before we go back on the network.
So you've got...
That's my favorite right there.
Yeah. But we didn't stop there. We got name sings.
Yay!
For everybody. Now, you've already heard...
I love that.
Which is funny.
It's coming handy. Too.
Always funny. And Rob used to have a shout. Now...
There's nothing like it. You're in this business. You hear your name sung.
Yeah. Mike, get ready.
Mike O'Meara.
Oh, that's nice.
Then you have our super producer,
Charlie Broy Hill.
And something special for Buzz.
Michael Elston as Buzz Burbank.
Wow.
And I got one, of course.
Don Geronimo.
And I was thinking in my radio career, I've had, like, maybe 50 of these names.
Right.
But never have I ever had one with my real name.
Michael Source.
Oh, that's great.
So those,
that is awesome.
But, like, those will just come into play on the show. Yeah. Like when Joe called, you know, if only he would have said Joe Artinger. And I said, you know,
or you could just say Stinky Poon.
All right, then you hear
Joe Artinger.
Boy, those are rich.
Yeah,
and thank you. Well, I'm saying thank you. We paid for them to the Jam Jingle Company from Dallas.
Truly the best, and if you care, that is actually the sound of 21 voices.
21 voices.
Yeah,
that is cool.
It is. And who's this on the inside line now? Hello?
Charlie Broyhill.
Oh, he wants...
Hold on.
Nice bush.
He'll take either one of them.
I got to learn where the buttons are.
Oh, that's great.
That's all. Yeah, so we've got those.
Hi, Don, it's me.
Who, Mike?
It's me, Mike O'Meara.
Mike O'Meara.
Hi, Mike.
Yeah.
It's me, your friend Don.
Don Geronimo.
Or am I speaking to you as...
Michael Sword.
Hey, where's my best buddy?
Buzz B. Wack.
And I'm really two people.
Michael Elston as Buzz Burbank.
Who's high?
Joe Artinger.
Oh, man.
Get ready. They're there.
You know, I know this guy that watched Mrs. Doubtfire today.
Michael Mann.
I know a guy who took about 1,000 pills today.
I know this guy that woke up with Frida this morning.
Michael Sores.
I know a new guy is getting a new TV set.
Raspy Wack.
I know a guy that's going to eat an S sandwich tonight.
Raspy Wack.
I know a guy who missed the
opening. Because he spent too much money on the TV set.
I know a guy who missed the opening of the show.
Michael Elston as Buzz Burbank.
I know a guy who's having a hard time keeping track of these buttons.
Don Geronimo.
But he'll figure it out because he's got the brain of...
Michael Sores.
Awful if I had the brain of...
Joe Artinger.
Nothing would happen on this show.
Oh, that's funny.
I like that.
And is that all right that Mike said that about the TV?
Yeah.
Is that how you want Carrie, your wife, to find out about it?
She's not listening.
Well, wait. I thought everybody knew everything. I thought you were already in trouble.
No, not yet. He's not in trouble yet.
There was a matter of price. It's her fault. Price adjustment.
It's her fault.
Somehow it always is.
The best strategy. I'll tell you whose fault.
I'm no one to discuss marital strategy, but, you know.
It's the fault of Carrie.
Really?
My wife. Although, she will think that someone else is at fault.
And, oh, I know, she's...
Raspy Wack.
Could you stop it?
You're going to wear him out.
Could you stop it, please? Today I'm at home.
Yes.
Oh, and when I'm at home, incidentally, I'm known
Michael
as...
Michael Sores.
Right. Hi. Hello. Actually, I was trying...
Michael Sores.
First I called...
Michael Mira.
Yes.
And I couldn't get him. Then I called...
Raspy Wack.
And I couldn't get him.
Did you call the guy in the studio next door?
No.
He's not playing. That's funny. That's even funnier.
I called to tell Mike, I saw the funniest thing, and this ends up getting around to Rob's TV. I was watching, I know you're wondering, who watches these press conferences at the Super Bowl? I do.
Hmm.
I do.
Michael Sores.
I do. On the NFL channel.
Right.
And... they were having the Carolina Panthers media day at the Super Bowl. And this the quarterback, and I know that Jake Delhomme has been compared to the water boy, and that's his nickname. I've never seen the guy really interviewed long form one-on-one.
Now, is he a Bubby Brister, Bayou, Brett Favre kind of guy?
He makes Bubby Brister look like Donald Trump.
Is he a Bayou, like Southern Louisiana type guy?
I am not exaggerating when I tell
Jake Delhomme, it sounds like you're French.
No. He has kind of this sound to his voice.
Hello, you know, I am not bright.
You know the way that we do that thing? And what is the great barometer of intelligence on this show? It's always been, if you say, and whatnot.
Yes. Whatnot is not allowed on this show. We don't like whatnot.
That shows us that you're just flat out a moron.
You are dumb as a box of cotton balls.
Well, I'm watching this guy, and within 3 minutes of him answering a question about if he thinks his success is anything like Tom Brady's or Kurt Warner's, he drops in 8 whatnots.
Wow.
Well, Tom Brady,
that's a record.
Tom Brady is a good quarterback. He's been here and whatnot. And Kurt Warner went through an awful. I was with him with Amsterdam and went to training camp and whatnot with you know, and it was 8 whatnots in
that
a row.
That is a public speaking world record for whatnots.
I mean, almost worse than that. I use it himself in third person. Mm-hmm. So I call Mike. I can't get Mike. I call Rob. I get Rob's wife, and Carrie says, no, he's not here, because Rob's had his TV was broken. Said Rob is out getting the TV fixed or figuring it out. Mm-hmm. I said, oh, good. And she said, but I told him, absolutely, he's not allowed to spend any money at all.
All right.
And I said, oh, all right, well, good for you. I'll call him on his cell. Bye-bye. I hung up the phone.
She truly did say that.
So now I
feel like I've busted you.
No.
Because I didn't know that. I thought
it's fine.
I thought that was already known.
He was going to have to tell her at some point.
Yeah. How were you, just that in essence it's out now, how were you planning on letting her know?
Well, I would start by telling her what a great deal it was.
And Rob,
had to step up a little bit.
Mm-hmm. I have to tell you something.
Yes?
That you're so much like me.
Yes.
Frida, that you don't want, you're afraid of her and you don't want to tell her. Do you realize that downstairs, that when you told me how much extra it was going to be,
yeah,
that just while you were telling me, it went up $100?
No, did it?
It did.
It's like 300, isn't it?
You started saying, and it's only going to cost me 200.
Uh-huh.
Oh.
And then you said, and after the guy came back with the thing, it's only going to cost me $300.
The telling is what it's doing. The story is forming.
Yes, it is.
But it comes with a built-in DVD player.
So you didn't feel like making a phone call and letting her know?
Well, she's very busy.
Yeah. She's busy. She finds out.
Who's very busy? Carrie. My wife.
She can't hurt him here.
Right. We have all the receipts. If she's really upset, she can get a price adjustment or something. That's what she does.
So we
carry it back on her back.
We were on the telephone.
Drink the NyQuil, dear.
And she's saying this. And then I came in and Rob pulled in and said, man, I got to tell you about the deal I got, that I got nothing but praise for it. What, who is it?
Circuit City.
Did a great job. They took his busted TV and he got a better TV and it only cost him $300. And the whole time I'm thinking, oh, man, dude, have I been there?
Right.
Where you've told your wife, or rather, your wife has told you that you can't do something. And you've gone ahead, it involves money, something...
Well, don't you do it almost because she tells you not to? Isn't that part of it, a little rebellion deep down inside?
Now it is.
Yes.
Now that, thank God, therefore, you know, the grace of God, now I got a couple of nickels I can rub together.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm talking back in the days when we'd had, like, no money.
And you really couldn't, you'd be jeopardizing your monthly
right.
nut.
Right. Yeah, right.
To go out and do something foolish like that, like
yet I would
get a Porsche.
Yet you're right.
Right.
I did. Yet I would do stuff like that all the time. So, Rob, I found out it's like pulling off a Band-Aid. Everybody tells that. It's the easiest way. Just call her up. Even if she's... Why don't you call her up now off the air? But right here.
The greatest thing would be is, you know, if she gets mad and doesn't speak to me, more time to spend with the television.
Just pick up the phone behind me and call her up and just tell her that you spent the $300 extra.
Oh, absolutely. So that'll be interesting.
Yeah. You know, because
it could be very interesting.
She'll be mad at you either way.
Right.
Yeah.
I've just found, like with Frida, it's easier just to tell her.
This way she'll have a couple hours to cool down before he gets home tonight.
Yeah, that'll work. Or it could fester for 3 hours.
She should be at home with this inclement weather, I would think.
Yeah. And the babies.
And the babies.
Unless she's shoveling. I'm kidding, of course.
No, you're not.
It's me. Hi, we're on the air. Have you been listening?
Tell her she's not on the air.
No, you're not on the air, but we are. I just want to let you know that in order to make the television deal go down right, we had to kick in $300.
She's talking now.
He's listening.
Okay.
He's listening. She's talking.
Because for all things to come together, actually it has to do with the price adjustment that you did after the fact on the old TV. Because it wasn't reflected on the receipt. How do you mean?
He's double talking.
No, no, because they figured out the receipt, but the receipt, when they went to the computer, it reflected the second
time. Every married guy out there knows this. This is...
So, remember we got...
Here's the bottom line. I used to think it all the time. I still do. It's his money.
Yeah.
He's having to argue with his wife about what he wants to do with his money.
You've been there.
And I'm sure he wouldn't have a complaint if she wanted to take $300 out to buy something.
No, probably not.
It shouldn't take too long.
What do I know? She's talking.
I'm still waiting.
It's the full value of what we paid for it, but we got $100 and some.
He's really
back.
Going through this, ladies and gentlemen.
This is not fake for radio.
This is real.
Listen to these big,
and they did.
But these big blocks of silence.
Also the service plan and the tuner.
Can you hear the confidence being sucked out of his voice?
The body language. Yeah. He's slouching now.
Shuffling his feet.
And I've noticed he's moving farther and farther away from me and the microphone.
And his cheeks are red.
Oh, dear.
See his cheeks? His cheeks were red. That's how you can tell.
All right, just want to let you know.
Can I talk to her?
Wow. Hold it. There you go. No, she's gone.
She's gone.
Oh, dear.
So how'd that go?
How did it go, Rob?
Because you always come over after you do that with one of our interviews. Tell us, how'd that interview go?
I don't think she's going to be welcome back on the show. That went about as well as one of the interviews.
Really? Wow. Okay. Well,
I'm sure it'll work out.
I'm sure it will.
There you go.
It happens.
Think she'll be in a better mood by Germany?
She might be sending me to Germany by myself. This is a one-way ticket.
Wow.
Well, you had to tell her eventually.
That's right. You had to find out.
Yeah, you had to tell her.
Yeah. Although I know that you probably had some sneaky way around it, didn't you?
Not really.
So you were going to try to go around until I opened my big mouth. I hope I didn't get you.
No. You know what? It's not you at all. Don't worry.
But you know, I don't have that to look forward to anymore. So maybe, you know, really kind of getting you guys in trouble is my way of getting a little bit of it, you know?
Wow.
Yeah.
Is it fun?
Yeah, it is.
Sorry,
it sure is.
A lot of fun.
It surely is.
Well, way to go, Rob.
Thank you.
Way to go. Way to sacrifice yourself for the show.
Very good, Rob. That was throwing yourself on the hand grenade. I like that a lot.
Nothing I love better than actually hearing that.
You like to hear other guys suffer, don't you?
Yeah, well, you know, I lay it out there.
Right. We're all in this together.
When my wife squeezes my sack like that and
sure.
just gets every bit of man that's in me out on the floor. And
I think we've heard it all.
She stomps on it. She spits on it. She dances on it. Look at all of that. And Rob, and normally Rob like me, and like you, like all of us,
right.
Boisterous, full of self-confidence,
right.
Yes. Very, very loud, very assertive. Well, how dare you tell us anything in the world? We are on the radio. You are listening to the radio. Mm-hmm. You obviously are not qualified.
Mm-hmm.
Yet listen behind the scenes.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah,
look,
right.
Look at him now.
Hey, you heard Adolf, huh?
Right. Do you see that? He's a kitten now.
There's a
tiny
power.
Ball of fur now.
Every Adolf has his Eva.
There you go. Like, yeah. Eva.
Eva Braun. Okay. That's
wow.
That's the first break of our radio show today.
After what viewing. A pleasant break it was.
Yeah, it was great.
It was... you know, we never got to my brother Jimmy, so I think we'll try to call him in the next couple of minutes.
Lots has happened to him, and I'd like to see how he's doing.
Well, I think winter update, just the winter update. From
winter is normally a sad time for him.
For my brother,
the season of Jimmy.
Yeah. Yes, it is. We should have gotten him a sing too.
Yes,
Jimmy Source.
Jimmy Source.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Hey, you're on the radio.
Yes, good evening. I'm thoroughly enjoying your show.
Oh, thank you.
I just wanted to ask you if you could expound on the plight of... there's an alleged serial killer that's been incarcerated for a number of years in the Washington, D.C. area prison. I don't remember which one it is.
You mean George W. Bush?
No, you idiot. I'm talking about Charles Broyhill.
Okay, well, I don't need that
Hi, you're on the radio. Charles Broyhill. If people want to look it up, fine.
Charlie Broyhill.
Click.
Oh, wait, I'll cut you off. I did. No,
hello?
Oh, you're still there. Great.
Yeah, hey, how you doing there?
Okay.
I caught that show last week where you had the prisoners calling. And someone asked you about this an alleged serial killer who's sitting in prison by the name of Charlie Broyhill. I was wondering if you did do any research on that. Because he's never been convicted. He's never been charged with anything. They say he's killed over 21 people. And it's have you checked into that? He's in a Maryland state prison. And he has his c**t in his hand, and he's on the Don and Mike show. Whoopee!
Oh.
You.
This is your best contribution ever.
Thank you.
And there was nobody on like that last week. It was 2 weeks ago. But I don't recall that call.
The Don and Mike show.
Pretty good, perfect guy. Wow, pretty good.
They'll put more cash in your khaki pants. Don and Mike.
You know, it's been a while, hasn't it?
Yeah, what is the radio station that just allows the F-bomb on the air?
An F-U.
Wow.
Which is really, whoopee!
Also, the added, like,
what? No, you idiot. Yeah, that was great in the first call.
Right.
Very matter of fact, no idiot.
No, Charlie Broyhill.
No, those were two separate calls that got packaged together.
Wow.
So anyway, here we are. We're doing the show now. Mike, I know you're very interested in our incest contest.
Oh, Jesus.
We have five finalists. We'll present them to you at some point during today's show.
Gosh, I hope we can get to it today.
Yeah.
And and then we'll select the winner, and that's where it will end.
Okay.
We'll want to hear from the people once they've won, and I won't trouble you with reading all of the incest letters that we've already heard.
Okay.
I'll summarize the incest letters we've heard.
We have some phone numbers, too.
Yes, yeah, we do. All have been semi-confirmed. Now, they've all been semi-confirmed because it's only been through email.
Wow. Yeah, and when we confirm, that means that there's somebody on the other end of the line. We still hold out, I still, as a crap detector, hold out the, you know, the penthouse letter thing.
Which, yeah, right, which is
some
why
of these is possible.
When we get to the five, we'll pick the one that we like the best.
Right.
Then we'll email the person back, unless they've included a phone number, to say, okay, now you got to come on the show.
Right.
And verify this. And just so you know, it's the best kind of incest we're talking about. Just brother and sister action.
Yeah, well, I'm feeling queasy already.
Although, the one letter did make the finals that the dad was involved in camping.
Yes.
But that was way after they were 18.
Right.
Dad took them camping. I bet you'd rather that we called my brother right now.
I'd rather do anything than that right now. You know that, though.
My brother, although, come on, some of these incest letters have...
No, I'm not coming on this one. No. I'll sit over here and, you know, just do what I normally do. Chuckle quietly to myself.
Funny. Some of them have been funny.
There's been a chuckle in some of these, yes. But by and large, it's that same feeling I get when someone actually runs not even fingernails, but some metal device across a chalkboard.
Oh, then you'll enjoy my report on incest in the news.
Oh, really?
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah,
it seems
news
to be quite the theme, ladies. Mm-hmm.
I want you to know that he's operating on his own there.
Right.
I didn't go to him and say more incest.
Well,
more
he's
often
with you on this. See, you don't need me for this because he's right there. He's real giddy about it. As a matter of fact, he's giddier than you are. I know why you're doing it. I'm more worried about him enjoying it.
I was an only child.
Oh, God, that's sick.
Okay, my brother Jim, who I'm sure of. Probably thought of incest when we were growing up. I'll ask
with you.
Yeah,
gay incest.
I'll ask him that question.
Very good.
You ever thought about some hot brother on brother action? We've not had him on the show yet in this calendar year. He's in Wisconsin where they're getting some real weather, unlike here in D.C. where we're getting a combination of a little rain and
we are getting
drizzle.
As much as I hate to admit it, we are getting the wintry mix.
Yes, we are.
Pain in the ass.
But Mike, it's the best mix.
Yes, the best mix.
That everybody can agree on.
Of the morning, the midday, and the evening.
So I know that he's getting some weather. Hey, dude.
Hey, man.
Hey, homo, here he is. All the way from America's heartland, the Dairyland, Wisconsin, my brother Jim. Hey, Jimmy.
Hey, Woody.
Jimmy, suddenly got a little throat problem.
Yeah, I do.
What's the prognosis?
I don't know. I haven't been to a doctor.
You have not
been? I just losing my voice, hacking up phlegm,
Yeah, I can relate. I got a little of that myself, and it's not fun.
Hey, did you ever think when we were growing up, did you ever think about incest with me?
What?
It's just a question I'm tossing out. I never did, but I was wondering if you ever did.
No.
Okay, good. That's the right answer.
You guys never saw each other in the shower or anything.
Well, what was your answer?
He said he was totally into it.
So Jimmy, listen, we're calling here for the winter update to find out your mood. You know, a lot of people like using the farmer's almanac or a Ouija board. I like calling my brother to find out, get a barometer of what's happening over the
next... You're going to say how many more weeks of winter there were.
The next few weeks and months. Jim, what's on your horizon? What do you see for all of us?
Six more weeks.
6 more weeks of winter?
Yeah.
But what do you see for us as a society over the next 6 to 12 weeks?
What do I see as a society?
Yeah, how's...
I don't even want to go there.
Really?
Are you encouraged? Are you discouraged?
Oh, I'm discouraged.
Yeah. Why is that?
Oh, it's just my girlfriend's job and all that. She tells me about all the people that are scamming.
All the people that are scamming.
Scamming
now.
What, Jim?
Oh, scamming welfare, scamming child support, and all that. And then I asked her, well, you guys are enforcement agents for child support. Why can't you guys do anything?
Yeah.
She says our hands are tied, mainly because of confidentiality laws.
Hey, Jimmy?
What?
Hold on, I got a phone call for you. Hold on. Long distance.
Oh,
hold on, listen. Long distance.
Oh, that was deep.
Did you recognize that voice?
No, I didn't.
Did you hear that, Jimmy?
I barely.
Yeah.
Aye. Well, he's sick. Wasted a great fart on him.
Jimmy, that was him farting into the phone.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my God. So,
okay, we all do it.
So oh, and I got to. Oh, my wife will kill me. She will kill. Rob, you did it, so I'll do it. I just want to say today, funny, great thing, great funny. My wife had been, you get a little bit of that over there?
Just a taste.
Don't forget what you sent over my way yesterday.
Oh, my God, yesterday. And they weren't that loud either.
They were SBDs, absolutely.
Absolutely. Yes,
silent but deadly.
Thank you, just a little bit.
Oh, like mine are so bad you need the spray.
Well, no, I don't. You tolerate mine better than I tolerate yours.
Just trying to be a cordial host.
Mine was worse yesterday than that one.
Like Julie, the cruise director.
Hey, what a new product.
Oust.
Yes.
Air
sanitizer.
Haven't you seen those ads?
No.
They're done like with the handheld video cameras to give you that look that the house frows are really believing in the product.
You know, this isn't citrus. I don't know what they call. Why do they call anything citrus? But go ahead. I interrupt.
Well, my wife.
Hey, let me ask you something.
What's that?
You know, when it's real cold out, like today right now, it's like 13 degrees out. Mm-hmm. And you know, when you breathe, you can see your breath.
Right.
Now, when you fart, is there a little cloud that comes out the back of your pants or what?
I think it's too dense.
Well, oh, okay.
Maybe if you did it pantless, if you...
You'd probably get a little steam.
If you spread your cheeks.
And immediately, you'd probably see a little puff.
I would think so, because of the temperature.
That's what I was wondering, because I fart quite a bit when I'm walking outside. That's cold.
Mm-hmm.
I can't see it. I've just always wondered that.
Well, we'll research that. Next time you're taking one of your walks, do it pantless.
Okay.
So today, my wife is downstairs doing her workout.
Right.
And she's leaving the area, and I'm going to get on the treadmill, and there's a bathroom downstairs by Grandma's room. And I walked into just an absolute wall of stink. And girls are so funny about this. My wife will probably be pissed about this that I'm even mentioning this. She said, I walked in, I went, whoa. When I walked in the bathroom, yeah. I said, what is going on? Jesus, is that you? You know, I could say to anybody.
Right.
She's like, just shut up, okay? I had to go to the bathroom. And I don't know how often...
Your wife is not a fan of things scatological in any way, shape, or form.
No, I think that generally she tries to hide anything like that from me.
She likes to be very dainty, and yes.
Which is what made it so great, because it was really just... putrid smell. Something so foul came from
that delicate flower.
A digestive tract. So beautiful.
So beautiful. So pretty.
Digestive tract.
Did you get the impression? I always notice when
Doug tract.
When you walk into a room like that, and I'm sure your wife didn't do this, but here at the station, the lack of courtesy flush. Is really a result. That's what, and a lot of guys just don't do that. I always do the courtesy flush.
Came in the other day, and I don't generally don't do a BM at the station, but if the urinal is full, then you got to go stand in the stall.
Right.
Someone did not do a courtesy flush, and there was no fecal matter
right.
that was still in the bowl. What was in the bowl were apparently pieces of lettuce and food stuff. Someone, I guess,
being lighter than the water, had not gone down.
Someone had just had for a business lunch or something.
Obviously, someone with a tremendous amount of roughage in their diet.
Yeah, yeah, but probably accounted for the reason they were in there in the first place.
Anyway, Jimmy.
Yeah,
Jimmy, what was so? You are discouraged because of welfare,
the scamming.
Just stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff like that in general.
What's good then? Let's turn it around. What's good in your opinion right now in America, in your life? What's good?
Anything encouraging?
I'd have to think about that for a while.
Now you're currently unemployed, right?
In my life, yeah. Well, no, I'm laid off.
You're laid off.
I got a job, so don't call me laid off this time.
Okay, so you're just waiting.
I'm just hanging out.
Waiting to go back to work. So
yeah.
What's good right now in America, then? You said you didn't like the scamming on welfare. What's good? What's good to get us through these next 6 weeks of winter?
The approval to go back to the moon and the space exploration projects.
So you're buying that?
Yeah, I'm buying into that.
Why?
I believe in that.
Why?
Don't maybe explain it, man.
Well, no.
I just do.
I'm serious. Why? Why do you believe it? I'm not saying...
I think we should explore.
Why?
There might be intelligent life out there.
All right. That's violent.
You know?
Don't you think that if there is, though, they probably already know about us and we're just too dumb for them?
I don't know.
Now, you think there's life on Mars?
I think there's a possibility that there's a planet in another galaxy out there that has life form just like us on it.
Well, you know, we've never gotten into discussion this deep with my brother before.
But it's great that you asked him for something positive. Mm-hmm. And, Jimmy, I identified one of the president's most positive...
Hey, I'm sorry for my opinion.
Don't ever be sorry for space exploration. Would you like...
I hear everybody criticizing Bush for all that, you know. But, hey, you know, I believe in it. I'm sorry.
I think that's fantastic.
That's okay.
And all right.
Would you like to go to Mars?
Yeah, I think that'd be cool.
What would be cool about it?
Hey, man, I'd just be able to stand there and flip off the Earth, you know?
There you go. All those people that are giving you a hard time.
Turn around and give them a moon.
Yeah, that's right. Give them their own moon.
But, Jimmy, you know, compared to the moon, Mars is way farther away. Compared to the moon,
it'd be a long journey.
Mars is like going to China.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Going to the moon is like going to Florida.
It would be very, very a lengthy trip.
I was
into that stuff Saturday night. I even on the internet clicked into the NASA TV and watched when the second thing landed on Mars and the whole bit. Mm-hmm. I was into it.
So you're into it, the angry red planet.
Yeah, man.
And how will you feel? I think, didn't the Russians find water on Mars, or didn't they have some Sputnik thing that...
Well, they didn't find water. They everything shows evidence that there could have been.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, which means, like, deep in the center of the planet, there might be spacemen.
Well, yeah, microorganisms and all that kind of...
Hey, your brother is into it.
Yeah,
see, it's a sign that. I didn't even know. You like
really
that.
Are.
Pretty cool. You could have been an astronaut, Jimmy.
No, he couldn't.
No.
There's no way. He's too dumb.
He's too dumb.
Okay, to be an
Moose.
Astronaut.
Moose? He called you Moose.
Yeah. Okay, I'm dumb. No, listen,
you
I'm...
Damn dummy.
Listen, I'm too dumb to be an astronaut, too. Don't worry about it. I did not know that you were that into it. I mean,
that's pretty cool.
Oh yeah.
Do you like space movies and stuff?
Yeah, I like a few of them.
You like Armageddon?
Didn't see it.
It's actually called Armageddon.
Oh yeah. Yeah, okay.
Did you see
it? Yeah, I'm not with it too much today.
Oh, that's okay.
It's all right.
It's snowing.
A little out of it because it's snowing. Hey, now listen, this would be a fantastic primer for people who live here in the Washington D.C. Baltimore area. How much snow are you getting up there in Wisconsin right now?
We had about 6 inches on the ground. We got about 3 to 4 last night and today.
All right, and is the entire society closing down because of it?
No.
People go about their daily lives, go to work, go to school.
School wasn't canceled or set back at all or nothing. Hey, man, this is it. You know, we deal with it.
That's how you deal with it.
There you go.
It's not like paralysis where you hear people on the news, you know, like the dads or this, and they go, yeah, I just figured I'd stay home.
There was a lot of that today. Yeah. And then I heard the part about the government shutting down.
Yeah, or your liberal leave or whatever they call it. They got like a million things to F off.
So everybody can get out of town before the big crazy storm gets here. You know, and one of these times...
Oh, yeah, it's nothing around here, you know.
The federal government today will be allowing people to leave 3 hours early.
I fully realize...
Why go in?
I go, one of these times, I am going to be proven wrong. One of these times, they're going to luck out, and there is going to be some major storm that actually does paralyze the area,
right,
and perhaps even kills me, and then they'll be able to laugh and say, huh, see, he never believed us, but this one time...
14, we've gotten 14 inches of snow here, 14 inches usually, it's a little over a foot, is what shuts things down. I think people have a lot of trouble with it.
But what we have here today, as opposed to what they have in Wisconsin, is
well, nothing. I think they've got a total of maybe 8 or 9 inches of snow in Wisconsin, and we've got 5.
Is it still snowing there now?
Yeah, over by Kenosha.
Over by Kenosha there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, hey there.
Well, that's Norvell's up there in Wisconsin.
And hey, let me just ask you, who's the best brother in the world? You know what my brother got me for Christmas? I have not even mentioned this.
What?
I thought that he had gotten me every possible Green Bay Packer product
right. That
was available. No. I'm talking now the Green Bay Packer... What do you? It looks like a helmet. It's that a tape measure.
Oh, a Green Bay Packer tape measure.
Yeah, it's like one of those big ones like you get at Home Depot. The kind that
you gotta love it.
You put on your belt, and it's the giant Packers helmet. I opened it up, and Frida said, "What is that?" And I said, "Oh, this is cool."
Yeah,
this is.
You love it.
I didn't know who would use it more, you or Frida.
Yeah, well, no, sure. I gave it to her to put it in the toolbox. But it, indeed, it was cool. All right, dude. Listen, we always ask for some parting words of wisdom before we let you go. You got a final send off for us?
Yeah, don't hurt your back shoving in the snow.
Very good. Great advice. Here coming from the snow belt, one of the snow belts in the United States.
All right, and Jimmy. NASCAR. Who do you like? NASCAR starts in a few weeks.
Jeff Gordon,
of course. That's right. I forgot you like that faggot.
Oh, man, don't even start.
And who you like in the Super Bowl?
Philadelphia.
We'll take that one. We'll write that one down.
That's my brother, the same guy that was just talking about his fascination with life on Mars.
Yes, well, he knows his football.
Who's in the Super Bowl?
It's Carolina.
You lost a couple weeks ago, didn't it?
Carolina and New England, Jimmy.
Yeah. I'm with you,
that's
Jimmy.
Right, that's right.
It's the Panthers and the Patriots, Jimmy.
Oh, I'm so dumb.
Well, no. That's why you're not an astronaut.
No,
yeah,
not.
But you had microorganisms on the show today, so that's pretty good. All right, dude, we'll keep in touch, and I'll talk to you soon. All right, I love you.
Love you, too. Bye.
All right, I'll see you. Goodbye. There he is, the damn dummy.
He's a great guy.
My brother Jim.
Bye. That really wasn't one, though, was it?
No. Oh, no.
No, that wasn't.
No, that was a real goodbye. That was a real goodbye. That was not one of those jabs.
I knew that.
Goodbye.
I knew that.
Goodbye. Be right back, everybody.
This is the Don and Mike Show. WJFK.
You know, it's a funny kind of a thing, but, you know, I feel better after I got all that off my chest. I feel like a load. A load is off my shoulders. You're good. Doc, thank you.
Mr. V, I didn't do anything.
Oh, you did something.
No, I did nothing.
You did something?
I didn't.
The load? Gone. Where is it? Don't know. You're good. Nah. You're good, Doc. You're good. I'm going to be getting in touch with you.
Oh,
just one more thing. If I talk to you and you turn me into a fag, I'm going to kill you. You understand?
Could we define fag? Because some feelings may come up.
I don't fag you, Doc.
The Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
This is Ghetto-licious.
They like them cow big. Don and Mike.
Right.
I like that one.
Let's see. It's time for our Super Bowl bit.
Ah. I like this Super Bowl bit.
We're doing a Super Bowl bit every day leading up to Friday, when we'll be broadcasting live from Houston from the Super Bowl. Mm-hmm. Now, I want you to know we were a nun's pubic hair away from the very violent Bo Jackson.
Really?
Yes, because he's doing some turkey something.
He's sending 200,000 pounds of rotisserie chicken to our troops overseas.
Something like that.
Rotisserie
chicken.
Is that his company, rotisserie?
And he says even Martians like chicken wings.
Really?
And if anybody bothered to read the gigantic cover story on him over the last 6 or 7 months in Sports Illustrated,
mm-hmm.
Bo Jackson is nuts.
Yeah.
Where they were saying, like, when he was out hunting squirrels with right. the reporter, that he enjoyed, I think the quote was something like, and I read it, I should remember it, especially enjoyed blowing their brains out, like getting close enough to...
Blowing their heads off?
shoot their
those
heads
nasty,
off.
Vicious squirrels.
Really? So Bo Jackson might still call... Where'd Rob go?
Rob left.
Because he told me Bo Jackson, just so you know,
right.
might call today for our wacky Super Bowl bit.
Cool.
But we're not sure, so we got some other guy.
We're moving on.
Let's talk Super Bowl. Psychologist. Is using psychology, to predict Carolina will beat the Patriots. This dude's name is John Murray. Let me see. He's been keeping values on each play in a game.
It's all about pressure, Don.
Yeah, I see that. Oh, right, you're right, Mike. Carolina has a 562 pressure index, and the Patriots have a 482 pressure index.
Those numbers sound relatively close. I'd like to know what his margin of error is.
It sounds to be like a big BS index. let's give him a call. And Bo Jackson still might call?
Who knows?
Who knows? Anytime for Bo Jackson.
Okay.
Crazy Bo.
Calling Dr. John F. Murray.
Hey, F. Murray. I think that guy, F. Murray Abraham.
Right. F. Murray Abraham won an Oscar in Amadeus.
F. me.
Your call cannot be completed as dialed.
Why?
Please check the number and...
Now, this phone call has a 562 pressure index. Let's know how he scores it.
I'd like to know who he picked last year.
That's right. These are good questions for an interview.
John Murray, hello.
John Murray, it's Don and Mike.
Hi, John, how are you?
Don and Mike, nice talking to you.
You too. Now, let's see, you're a licensed sports psychologist.
Yes.
Now, first off, what does that mean, sir? Does that mean that you work with athletes or... Do you analyze the way that the layman looks at sports?
What it means is I'm, first of all, a licensed psychologist, and I've got the additional training and specialization in working with athletes to help them improve performance.
And I always get you guys mixed up, psychologist and psychiatrist. Are you the guy? Are you the one that can write prescriptions?
No, I don't get into the medication at all.
He's not a psychiatrist. He's a psychologist. Right? Are there any big name athletes that you work with?
There's lots of them. Yeah, most of my work is confidential, but occasionally.
That's right. I guess they wouldn't want to know this.
Yeah, you got to be careful there.
You got any names? Anybody that doesn't care? Say that they've been to a psychologist?
Yeah, no, actually, it's not an embarrassing thing because I'm helping people have more success. I'll give you an example. Vince Spadia is a tennis player that came out in Tennis Week in Reuters last year.
Never heard of him.
Well, okay, he's number 4 in the country in terms of he's top 30 in the world as a tennis player. So,
do you work with golfers also?
Yep, certainly do.
Okay.
Who did you pick last year in the Super Bowl?
Last year, the MPI, that's the index that I developed, picked Tampa Bay in a blowout.
That's the Murray Performance Index.
You picked Tampa Bay in a blowout?
Yeah, there were lots of stories written about it. ESPN, the magazine, covered it, and it was it looked like Tampa Bay was going to win big. I said more than 2 touchdowns. I went on Bloomberg Radio. I went on a number of different stations talking about it, and it actually came true, and Arizona Republic wrote about it afterwards.
Wow. Did you pick the championship games?
Actually, no. I looked at every single game in the playoffs last year and this year. In fact, I looked at every single play, if you want to get down to a more microscopic level. But no, actually, the only thing I did was describe how the teams were doing before the big game.
So you looked at every single play from the Panthers and Eagles game and the Patriots-Colts game?
Absolutely. I looked at every play in the playoffs. So we got 10 total games, and we dissected. And what we do is we see how the team's performing on every play. So what I like to think is that I have a different, maybe a more accurate way of looking at performance than...
Do you have on a white lab coat right now?
Yes, I do. We got rats running across my desk. Just kidding.
So what would be the ultimate point score for your pressure index? How would that, what would be something that an athlete or a team could do? Obviously, with fourth quarter, time running out, I mean,
right.
All those factors factor in?
Yeah, the pressure index, which is one of the factors, is critical moments, critical pressure moments. There's about a third or fourth of the plays, like third and fourth down key plays.
You've got this statistically laid out, even though it's
this is such bull.
Seems to work.
This is just such bull. You can't. I mean, you can predict to a certain extent guys who are going to do well in a game. Well, for instance, Jake Delhomme.
Okay.
The quarterback of the Panthers. You think the Panthers are going to win? So you think he's going to have a good day? I'm not talking about he doesn't have to pass more than 15 times, but even if that's the game plan, has a good day?
I'm not looking at how people feel or how I feel. I'm just looking at how he performed in the past. And no prediction system's perfect, and this isn't even for that. What I'm trying to do is show people how to stay focused in the moment. And what my system measures is that particular moment, which is the play.
What would you think about a quarterback at the Super Bowl who, when interviewed, used the phrase, whatnot, eight times within 2 minutes?
Well, I don't know, but if he can throw the ball, he can say whatnot, you know, 20 times.
So intelligence, as far as speaking to the press, doesn't necessarily matter on this index.
You know what? I'm just looking at performance. I'm looking at execution. And
what about if they're just dreamy like Tom Brady? Look at that cleft in his chin.
Do good looks influence your index at all?
Yeah, that absolutely has a major factor in this. Just kidding.
You know, I don't know. I really don't.
He was right last year.
He was right last year.
So he says.
How many Super Bowls have you done this for?
No, I've only done this for the last couple of years. I started it last year, the beginning of the year, and so this is really my second shot. And
only the second year.
Long a track record, but the Tampa thing is impressive.
Well, I don't think it's going to be a blowout like last year. I think it's going to be an extremely close game. The Panthers are better on paper.
I was thinking we could do a bet. You know that we could do a bet because I like this. I like the way he. But I still haven't gotten the answer that I need from you.
No, hold on. Let me see if I get what you're saying. You would do a bet with me, and you would take the Patriots.
I'd take the Carolina Panthers because he's saying it's going to be that they're going to be.
But either way, regardless of who I would take,
even though the Carolina Panthers are underdogs,
you would take the team based on some quack that we're doing on our Super Bowl.
I like the theory. Yeah. I do. I like the pressure in there.
Yeah. I wish I could have become a quack with 10 years of graduate school and 3 advanced degrees. I wish that was so easy.
Do you do it for baseball too?
It'd be none.
I work with athletes in all sports. I haven't developed an index for that, but
do you think you could do the same kind of index for baseball?
I'd have to look into that. I think I apply the principles in all my workshops and lectures and so forth.
I would assume, John, that it would probably be easier for baseball.
It really would. I mean, you're talking about a pitch and so forth, but for this particular sport, I think my knowledge and my understanding of statistics comes to play here too. It's not, I like to think it's a little more accurate than quackery.
Come on, man.
You guys are fun, you know that?
We're gonna have to agree to disagree because I this fascinates me.
So you believe in the
Murray
Performance Index?
I'm a big baseball fan, and you know statistics nowadays in baseball are so huge.
It's all about right here in the ticker. That cannot be computed.
It's all about the pressure, and I like statistical analysis of the pressure moments. I do like that.
So
I like
now
that a lot.
So
I don't know. What worries me is that Dr. Murray is saying that it's it's close, and I see that the 562 to 482, that's too close. Did you pick Tampa in a blowout last year?
I actually did. I went on Bloomberg Radio and said they win by more than 2 touchdowns. So
now you know last year nobody was doing that.
Well, I don't care what everybody does.
I was looking at my skeptical partner over here.
Okay.
Yeah, but I think you could find guys last year if you bothered. Sure. It's like even a blind squirrel.
Well, you could find one of those guys in the back of the sports section, one of those, my Paulie will be, you know.
No, and I'm sure that here's my only problem with
you think
guy.
He's throwing darts and just making it up?
It's the fact that he's a quack.
He's not a quack.
He's only done it for 2 years.
Right.
Like the second reason. You want to impress me? Get it right this year, then get it right next year. And then get it right the year after that. Get like four. I'm not saying you have to predict who's going to be in the Super Bowl. Just predict the winner.
It's
4 years in a row.
Well, you know what? This is based on reality. A lot of people talk, but I'm not. You know, it may or may not work this year. But the fact is, they did perform that way, and it looks like Carolina's a little stronger this year. That's all I can really say.
And you're talking about your analysis, your statistical analysis is on the pressure plays.
Everything. It's not just, it's the offense, defense, and special teams and how the team did in that particular moment. So most people look at two or three flashy plays.
What about like in the Patriots game where you got a ball that's tipped and then tipped again and then tipped again? That's not pressure, my friend. You know what that is? That's luck. That simply is luck.
Okay, but I'll look at where the pass was thrown, for example, in terms of how they executed. And if there's some luck involved, I'm going to take that factor out. So I'm looking at actual performance, not the outcome. And that's what I'm trying to do so much in my work with athletes, is help them to focus back on what's important, which is the moment, and getting back to that, focusing.
Who's the most effed up athlete that you've ever tried to help?
If I said that, I think I'd be in trouble. But
Now, without naming names, are there a lot of NFL guys that come to see you because their head is not right?
I mean, people do come to see me for issues. I was written about, for example, in Sports Illustrated, they covered
Show off.
article, sorry about that, depression. There's all kinds of issues that come up in sports.
Didn't this really get its genesis with golf? Didn't golfers really first get into this, going to see sports psychologists?
I think so, because, I mean, 99% of the time you're walking to the next shot, and so that one shot is so important. But, you know, the trend is changing. People in football and baseball and basketball, they're all starting to get more involved in this.
Sure. Okay, Doc. Hey, listen, I tell you, I got a theme for you right here. Listen to this.
You're playing the carnival music.
Yes, I am.
I'm 100% behind him. In fact, I'm going to go see him for my golf game. I'm going to go see Dr. Murray. I am.
Dr. Murray with his fantastic... Now, listen, you might be a good sports psychologist. I'll give you that. But as far as picking Super Bowls, you're 1-0.
Well, you've got a promise to bring me back on after Carolina wins this game.
Oh, that is
absolutely
an absolute promise.
Cool.
Okay, and listeners out there, go to smartproinsight.com. That's where you can see all the numbers and make your own decision.
Is there a picture of you there?
You know what? I know you. You'll go to that to look at it.
And just go to smartproinsight.com.
Because you're such a sports, you're a football junkie.
No, I'll go there.
I know.
I'll look at the website. I think the guy's a quack, but I'll go to his website.
So check it out. See if I'm a quack. I don't think, you know, make your own decision on that.
Okay.
I went to maybe the funniest site that I've seen in a long time. It's, that thing, that people mover thing, the Segway.
Right.
It's a site, maybe it's www.extremesegway.com.
Right.
And it's a goof site, because you know that Segway thing.
Is that the little motorized scooter with the two wheels?
Right. Yeah, and it goes like 5 miles an hour.
Side by side, right?
And they've got guys wearing helmets and like X Game gears, you know, driving up over curbs.
In the Segway?
In the Segway. But the curb, the curb is just a regular curb, and the Segway only goes 5 miles an hour.
Do you do pressure analysis for the X Games, Doc?
Oh, absolutely.
Buzz pulled up his website, and take a look at it, Mike.
The picture's small, but it's
Let me
there.
See. Look at the picture and just tell me the first word that comes to your mind isn't quack. Look at it.
No.
Look at it.
No, totally legit.
No, you guys will, I appreciate your humor and also bringing this to light. More people need to focus on the moment.
So are you confident, if you were going to give a percentage for confidence, how confident are you in your pick for this Super Bowl?
Oh, I can't say that.
You're under pressure. You're under pressure, doctor. No, don't be like one of those weather guys. You think that Carolina is going to win.
Let me tell you this. Last year I was 100% confident because the numbers were so clearly in Tampa Bay's favor. Okay, this year it's a very close game. But the pressure situation seemed to favor Carolina, as well as the defensive advantage. Their defense seems to be better than...
So give us the point total.
Well, I'd say it's maybe somewhere between 4 and 7 points in Carolina's favor. But
so less than a touchdown or less?
A touchdown or less in Carolina's favor.
Stop it.
And you'll come back. If they win, you'll come back on the show.
Oh, absolutely.
Right. And when they lose, you'll come back on the show?
I'll come back, and yeah, you can say whatever you want to me then. You've already done enough damage. Just kidding. It was a lot of fun. You guys are a lot of fun.
Now, listen, you wait till you get like 25,000 web hits just off that little mention you gave.
Yes. You mean I can say Smart Pro Insight again?
Sure. Sure. You can you hear that? Say it all you want. He can hear that, yeah.
Good.
Here he is, Dr. Quack Murray.
God.
And who knows, maybe Monday we'll come back from Houston and I'll have egg on my face.
Right.
And
you know me, the great believer.
I don't think any way the Patriots lose this game. They're just too good a team, but the Murray Performance Index says that the Panthers will win.
That's a trademark name.
By 4 to 7 points. 4 to 7 points.
Right.
All right, well, listen, Doc. It's been great. Thanks for joining us.
I enjoyed it. You guys have fun.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Murray.
Bye-bye.
Bye. You didn't like him.
No.
I'm totally with him.
It's a bunch of BS.
No, you're wrong. You're wrong. You're gonna find out when the Panthers win that game.
It's science.
When you think about it, look at it. His MPI.
Remind me of last year. Wasn't last year? Did anybody was Tampa Bay overwhelmingly favored last year?
They were favored by more than.
I don't remember. I don't remember that.
I don't know if they were favored as by as many as
New England's favorite now
over Carolina. And I know that it wasn't a sexy pick to pick Oakland last year, but it was a lot of people thought, yeah, Oakland's that good.
Yeah, exactly.
And look at this guy right here. He assigns point values on each play in a game and how focused a player was during a play and how he performed under pressure.
Right.
You
may be mocking him, but I know you're going to be on that website, Mr. Fantasy.
Here's the thing. If you're a guy...
You'll be paying attention to his numbers, Mr. Smarty Man.
How do you know how focused any player was during any play?
By how they performed in that particular play under pressure.
That's why I'm totally for the Murray Performance Index.
Here in Arlington, Virginia.
Arlington, Virginia right now. If you keep it total, the pressure index is 562 for the Panthers and 482 for the Patriots.
Anyway, that's what that guy says. That's Dr. F. Murray and F. him.
yeah, okay.
No, I'm kidding. He's all right.
I know you're
kidding. I'm just goofing him. That's why we booked these guys.
I know. I liked them.
Dumb Super Bowl guys. So hold on. Hold on to that for next week.
Rob.
Just in case, God forbid, he's right, and I have to call him back dumb. He's right, but
you heard what he said. It's gonna be a close game, and but I'm going out. I'm laying down $10,000 right now in Carolina.
He said the Panthers are gonna win.
Yeah, by 7 to 4 points.
You heard him, Dr. Quack. We'll be this will run. That was Dr. Quack, and we'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Oh, shake your head.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
So you know about the therapist. Well, let me tell you something. He does not make any decisions. I make the decisions, okay?
Then he can produce the show, and you can come to my office, lie on my couch, and cry about your mammy.
Oh, really? Well, he doesn't care about the show.
The Don and Mike Show. Their comedy is partly shtick. Don and Mike.
Now listen, maybe today on the show, we'll give this away if you live in the D.C. Baltimore area. Super Bowl Sunday with Rob Spiewak.
Yeah.
Rob Spiewak.
That's right. The ultimate big game party six-pack, a table for six. ESPN's own screening room where there's a 16-foot TV to watch the Super Bowl. Dinner buffet and ESPN's own game cards. Join Rob Spiewak.
Rob Spiewak.
From 5 till 7 as he hosts a big game party at the ESPN Zone in D.C.
All right.
We'll give that away later on today's show. Well, this is good for us because we like doing Regis Philbin bits. And we like doing Regis Philbin and Gelman bits.
Yes.
And he's got to be happy. I watched the Regis show today. I've heard the story about him coming back to do the Millionaire show. And I've watched it the last couple of days and he's not there. He's on vacation. But you know that somewhere the old man is smiling. Regis Philbin, who was obviously pissed because ABC screwed up his Who Wants to Be a Millionaire show by running it too much.
It went down the toilet.
Anyway, now that they're the ABC is the worst, even worse than Fox, ABC is close to WB and UPN territory, they're bringing back Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. They're making the prize worth more.
Mm-hmm.
$10 million.
Ooh. Who wants to be a multimillionaire?
Yeah. And it's just going to be on during sweeps, just during important ratings times. It's with a revamped format.
I'll be naked.
Hold on. This is the funniest description of Regis I have ever read in my life. The show features the return of the toothy grinned, tangerine skinned host with the most.
My tangerine skin.
Wow. It's from ABC.
How do you like my tangerine skin? It's always in the booth.
I like your toothy grin.
I got a toothy grin.
That goes with your tangerine skin.
Swanee.
And they're calling the show Super Millionaire.
Super Millionaire because it's $10 million instead of the regular million.
That's right. Really.
And everybody wants to know, yes, the fastest finger is back.
Oh, good.
Yeah, thank God they...
Fastest finger.
Thank God they kept that.
That's always reserved for Michael Gelman.
cute. Anyway, he was upset, and I guess Regis is upset that, Kelly has a show.
That's right.
So now
she's not going to be the only one double dipping.
So he,
I would have to go over on her TV show and pick up the crumbs, bitch.
He's got the show. Incidentally, the guy that won the most money ever has been on our show,
right.
And also the guy who won the first ever $1 million has been on our show.
We were addicted to that show. You were addicted to that show at the very beginning.
I was, and the guy...
Said, and then you also predicted its demise.
I think the guy who won the million, but the first $1 million winner was a listener on our show, right?
Right, and you recall one of the people on this show was a lifeline.
Ah, that's right. That would be Rob Spiewak.
Rob Spiewak, that's right. And he never called you.
He never did, but he sent me some cash.
Nice. And celebrity millionaire, right?
And Mankind.
Oh, Mankind, you were his life.
Wait, no, that's right, you were.
That's right.
No, but there was, don't you remember, one of these guys that won like 300 grand on the show had Rob as his lifeline and gave Rob a small percentage of the winning money.
That's right, because you did get a call.
That's right, and I used it to buy a television.
The excess. And Mankind offered me the chance to be his phone-a-friend. It never got to that. Actually, that day on the show, remember, they called up and said, stand by.
Right.
But apparently he was getting closer to the phone-a-friend.
And he was out at level one.
Yep, that was it. He was out. Mankind will be on the show tomorrow, Mick Foley. Last night I happened to be flipping around, and I went to Raw.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Raw that's on? Yeah, it's Raw that's on Monday. Mm-hmm. It was in Hershey. Oh. Hershey, PA.
A great town, a great horse.
A great pony.
Oh, God. I forgot about your daughters.
That's right, the pony.
Hershey, the pony. I'm sorry. That's your daughters are mine.
Got him carrots this weekend.
Carrots. Anyway.
Lovely carrots.
He was there. I don't know if he was wrestling, but at the very beginning he came running out, and they went...
Wrestling's big up in Hershey.
They went crazy. Mike, I know you, like myself, fans of the band Jethro Tull. Now, come on.
Stop running down his nose. Yes.
I mean, I think growing up, they were not an influential band for me, but
they were...
They
were fun to listen to.
I liked Jethro Tull. I liked Let's Bungle in the Jungle, mm-hmm. and I bought some of their albums.
And I always enjoyed it, as even to this day, you will hear an occasional disc jockey say, that's Jethro Tull. I love his music.
That's right. It's great rock and roll flute.
Right. So, anyway.
God.
Have you ever heard of a guy named David Palmer? He's the keyboardist for Jethro Tull. He's just had a sex change operation.
Oh,
he will now record as a woman named Dee.
Dee Palmer? Wow.
David Palmer, 66.
Is that the best time to have your sex change, at the end of your life.
Absolutely. He's an attractive blonde. He has felt the urge to be a woman since he was three. And he says the whole time that he was on stage with Jethro Tull, he would think about being a woman.
Oh, that how difficult that must have been for him.
And Ian Anderson has a statement.
Oh, good. Okay, good.
Like many other people who have known David for three decades as a bearded, pipe-smoking man's man, I found it difficult to understand at first.
Mm-hmm.
But I fully support his decision to undertake a new life as a woman. However, he will not be invited to be in Jethro Tull.
Oh. You can't blame
him. That's it.
Yeah. That'd be a little too much. Hey, these guys,
I understand.
They've been doing it for a million years.
You cut off your D and your B's, and you grow breasts.
Now, don't you think, though, if they really wanted to make some money on the tour, I mean, I'm sure, you know, Jethro Tull has fans all over the world, but I would think that if you really wanted to market that the right way, come on, see the freak.
When they get down to the state fair level,
right?
And I still don't think Jethro Tull's at that level quite yet.
Yeah, state fair is not tall. You know, I mean, even when they get to that level,
it depends how bad you need the money.
They might just have to go on an elevator somewhere.
Right. Do you think that the Go-Go's would take him in
with their videotape?
Mike, I know that you're big for your man Wesley Clark.
Yes,
and you know I'm for Bush. Now here is.
Can I tell you a story though? I'm big. And this is for anybody that's involved in any kind of supporting any kind of candidate early on.
Mm-hmm.
And if you make a donation to a campaign, which I did, it's and I'm sure that the Clark campaign is like campaigns all over the place. Once you do that, it's out there. And I don't want to say that I get emails every day, but I get emails beyond beyond what I've ever seen before. And, wow. and occasionally I'm
interested. Because you're the big fish, because you sent some money.
And it's just every single day. And I think that's what they do. They send out the, in the internet age, that's what they do. They send these mass things out. And really, I don't want to say it's to a point that I get frustrated, but you get so many of them and you finally just go, you know, I did it. I'm not one of these guys that's gonna fly into the state and right. do that. I got a guy. I like what he had to say, and I donated some money to him. And I'm not going to call people in New Hampshire. I'm not going to do that. You know, I'm really not, because I just don't. I wouldn't feel comfortable.
They sent you an email asking you to call people in New Hampshire.
They sent me an email asking for you get emails for money. You get emails for call, you get emails to drive to another state where there's another primary to go door to door. I mean, that's how they get these organizations, and they're people that are motivated. You know?
That's your guy.
Mm-hmm.
I like the dummy we have already.
Right.
He's fine. And listen, I think if the rest of you guys were simply honest, like I am, the way I look at it, the way I understand it, he wants to take 31% of what I earn. And the other guy wants to take 39%.
Mm-hmm.
So I want more money. Is that selfish of me? Yes. Yes. And really, like I told you all along, my thought is, it doesn't matter who's up there. I've really always thought that. The president, it's nice. It's really, though, it doesn't have anything to do with my life.
I couldn't agree with you more.
My day-to-day life. I know. Well, you take it seriously. I don't. But I got to say, for my man W., now, I think this would be a smart move. They're denying it at the White House that Dick Cheney's out for the re-election, and in is Giuliani. Now, I'm thinking...
Oh, that would be big.
You got a
chance, I think I'm a political junkie. That would be big.
You got a chance to get rid of Cheney, who is like a Big Mac away from a dirt nap anyway.
Well, and he's also a lightning rod for a lot of criticism from from the other side.
So anyway, that's the big rumor going around. Bush is not saying anything, but Giuliani's not saying anything.
You know, and they could make that segue based on the health problems, and it would probably be an easy one.
Right.
But if Cheney didn't want to go along with it, that would cause a lot of problems.
Well, Mike, then he'd have to have an accident.
He'd have to have a heart.
Got
to
be eager to get back to Halliburton.
Now,
now.
Time to shovel more snow, Mr. Cheney.
Yeah, tell him to come over to the White House, clean off the front porch. All of the Oscar nominations came out today.
Oh, they did.
I won't bore you with this because the Razzies came out. That's the one that I think we should really care about.
Right, yeah.
Lord of the Ring, Master and Commander.
Are these the regular nominees?
Yeah, the one for Best Movie. Johnny Depp, I thought that was interesting, got nominated for that dumb pirate movie. For
Pirates of the Caribbean, right.
Yeah. Bill Murray walked out on that movie, Lost in Translation. But
how do you feel about that with all the accolades? Do you think it was just the day or something?
I've thought about it in great depth, and I stand behind. Listen, I like Bill Murray. I'm a Bill Murray fan. I went into the movie ready to laugh. I just didn't laugh. Go see Lost in Translation and tell me...
Is it a comedy?
No. It is.
Well, then.
What it is, I'll give you this. It's an accurate depiction of an American in a foreign country who doesn't know anything and spends a lot of time walking around his hotel room looking at the various stuff in his hotel room.
Okay.
If you think that's funny...
But if it's not supposed to be funny...
No, it's a dark comedy.
It's a dark comedy.
It's a dark comedy. Right. Anyway, and Seabiscuit, of course, and Diane Keaton, and all that stuff. That's not.
Did Charlize Theron get nominated for Monster?
Yes, she did.
Okay.
Yes, she did. The ones that we care about on this show are the Razzies.
Right.
And here are your nominees. Worst Picture of the Year. Now, you would think that it would be all Geely.
You would think.
Sure. You would think. But think about this. They've spread it out, and they've done a great job.
Okay.
For Worst Picture, you have Geely, The Real Cancun, from Justin to Kelly,
right.
Charlie's Angels, Full Throttle.
There was some crap last year.
Yeah. And The Cat in the Hat.
Good.
Good.
I hated The Cat in the Hat.
Worst Actor, Ben Affleck. For either Daredevil, Geely, or Paycheck.
So many to choose from.
Now, Mike, don't you and I feel good about our conversation with Jim Nantz?
Yes.
Nominated for Worst Actor, Cuba Gooding Jr. for Boat Trip, The Fighting Temptations, and Radio.
Wow, three. Another three for Cuba Gooding Jr.
Justin from Justin to Kelly, he got nominated. Ashton Kutcher got nominated for his roles in Cheaper by the Dozen, Just Married, and My Boss's Daughter. And Mike Myers for The Cat in the Hat.
Oh, The Cat in the Hat gets slammed.
Yeah. Worst Actress from Charlie's Angels, both Drew Barrymore and Cameron Diaz.
Okay.
Kelly Clarkson from Justin to Kelly. Angelina Jolie for her Laura Croft movie. And Jennifer Lopez for Geely.
Geely.
Worst Supporting Actor, Anthony Anderson for Kangaroo Jack. Alec Baldwin, The Cat in the Hat. Al Pacino, Geely.
Alec Baldwin, The Cat in the Hat. That's great.
Sylvester Stallone in Spy Kids 3D.
Oh, now, you know what? I've got Cat in the Hat experience and Spy Kids 3D experience. And let me tell you something. Without question, the worst role of the year was Sylvester Stallone Spy Kids 3D.
I didn't even see the movie, but from seeing him on Good Morning America,
right,
where he's in the scene where he plays like five or six different characters.
And he's horrible. He's horrible. And, you know, and he thinks he's funny, and it's the worst.
Let me see. They have so many categories. This should be on TV. This one should be on TV. Not the Oscars.
And you make people show up and collect the award.
Let me see. A worst screen couple, worst supporting actress, worst... how about this? Worst excuse for an actual movie.
Okay.
Too Fast, Too Furious. Oh. Wow. And then all the ones you've heard. Charlie's Angels, Cat in the Hat, Justin to Kelly, Real Cancun. Worst remake or sequel. Okay. What a great category.
It is.
Too Fast, Too Furious, Charlie's Angels, Full Throttle, Dumb and Dumber When Harry Met Lloyd.
Dumb and Dumber, right.
From Justin to Kelly, because that was a remake of Where the Boys Are,
mm-hmm.
and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And then you have the worst director. They have the director of Geely, Justin to Kelly, Boat Trip. Now, here's where these guys just must have a hard-on against The Matrix. Because you have the Wachowski boys,
yeah,
from The Matrix.
Right.
They're in there for worst director, and then the guy from Cat in the Hat. And then worst screenplay is Cat in the Hat.
Now, do they have The Matrix in any of the other categories? Just director.
Just in director.
They don't have a little Keanu or anything like that?
No, they just got a boner against those two guys.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So anyway, that's what's happening with the Razzies, which is more important than the Oscars. Michael Jackson, I don't have time to get into all this, but Michael Jackson locked himself in his panic room yesterday and was not able to get out. Mike, if I was to ask you, when Bill Clinton was president,
mm-hmm.
We of course knew about the computers and emails. In the entire 8 years that he was in office, how many emails did President Clinton send, do you think? You can round it off to the nearest 10, 50, 100, or 1,000. How many emails did Clinton send?
I'd say he sent, in the 8 years he was in?
Yep.
I'd say he sent probably 50,000.
And everything's included, you know, mm-hmm. you know, personal and work.
Business, I have to disqualify myself. I know the answer.
Mike, the answer is two.
Two?
Two.
He only sent two emails.
Only sent them to.
Who did he send them to?
Well, one of them doesn't even really qualify.
Well, how are you, Monica?
One of them... No, it's not her.
I forwarded this website to
He did send one to John Glenn. Mm-hmm. After John Glenn went up on the space shuttle, he sent one to him.
Great trip!
And the other one that he sent doesn't really qualify because one of his aides sent him a test email to see if he knew how to push the button to send a reply.
I can't figure this crap out.
No.
My God, this is complicated. How are you?
The whole time the guy's there. It's two.
Yeah,
two emails.
That's surprising.
You know, it's funny. In their presidencies, he only sent two more than Thomas Jefferson.
Listen, this is bad. This is bad. Adam Sandler, who I normally like and I like his movies, mm-hmm. he's remaking The Longest Yard, the Burt Reynolds movie.
Oh, is that a good idea?
Please don't do that.
Here's the deal. Are we getting old, or is the fact that are they doing these remakes a little too soon?
No, they're just running out of ideas.
They're running out of ideas.
There are no good ideas.
And they are too soon.
Now, here is a good idea.
Burt Reynolds, probably Burt Reynolds' best movie.
Meet the Fockers. Now, I already said Dustin Hoffman wants to be Ben Stiller's dad.
For me, you get a sequel like that. You get a funny movie, which really lends itself to a sequel, mm-hmm. and then you bring in another big-name actor.
Right. Ready for this one?
Yeah.
She's thinking about it. She won't commit to it. Playing Mrs. Fokker, Barbara Streisand.
Oh,
now,
God.
That's funny.
That's fantastic.
You have Dustin Hoffman Streisand meeting Robert De Niro.
That would be awesome. She's reading the script.
That would be funny.
That would be great.
Yeah. just, I don't have time for everything else.
There's so much.
For goodness sakes. Doris Roberts would be thrilled if Everybody Loves Raymond had a spinoff show with the people that play the in-laws. Fred Willard and the lady that was Ted Baxter's girlfriend and Chris Elliott. They're like one of the worst parts of Everybody Loves Raymond.
I mean, you could get Brad Garrett. There's a spinoff. Brad Garrett would be funny.
You get to the point in any situation comedy on TV after they've been on 5 years or so where they flat run out of ideas. So either they have kids,
right,
or they just bring on these extra people.
And spinoffs work. I mean, spinoffs work very successfully in television. Frasier, look at that. No?
Doris Roberts says they are totally different in their way.
They're different, dude.
But just as dysfunctional as Frank and Marie Barone.
Yeah, look how successful The Wedding Show was as a spinoff of this show.
The Wedding Show.
And I just have to say one more thing. Tom Brady, who was at the State of the Union address, has not voted in 8 years. And,
there you go.
And Tom Brady also said,
why don't you come up here and watch the State of the Union with me?
In the new ESPN magazine, Tom Brady says that his craziest ambition is to be a U.S. senator.
That is crazy.
Tom?
So he hasn't voted in 8 years.
I think you got to vote first.
Might be a real good idea.
Yeah. That's what I had for you. Phone scan time right now. Oh, and I didn't have time to mention this. The best hair in Hollywood.
Yeah.
It's Halle Berry. And for the men, it's Mel Gibson. I always thought Mel Gibson wore a piece.
It's not Mel Gibson. It's the director of Lord of the Rings. That's the best hair in Hollywood.
No, you know the best.
I saw him at the Golden Globes the other night.
Oh, that guy, like the comic book salesman.
Right.
On this show, the best hair on this show? Well.
Michael Elton is Buzz.
And he will never be unseated in that area.
No.
Even though he colors it.
That's my story. Yeah, I joke with a real life man with beard. Listen, call now. That's what that means. It's phone scan time. Come on. All right, you animals. 877-365-3636.
Really, Buzz. Don't let anybody take anything away from you. That is a lovely wig.
From in America. Call now. Your call's unscreened in a random style phone scan, which is lying straight ahead.
Could be worse. Could be like Mel Cooley standing in the back of Don right over there.
Okay. Right. We'll be right back, everybody. Yes, we are. WJFK.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Why don't you take your love and shove it up your big fat ass? You know you're the reason we're through. I'm not all the yelling and the fights that we had. It won't be cold to you.
See?
Hey, you moan and you groan and you bitch and you whine. You make every beef we got last.
See?
Well, I'm telling you, baby, I'm through with you. Take your love, shove it up your big fat ass.
Don and Mike Show. You can call Don and Mike anytime from anywhere in America. 877-365-3636. They're ready to believe you.
I must say, from where I sit, I am truly enjoying your colorful patois.
Right. The cure for love, Kansas. The Don and Mike Show.
Yeah, Charlie.
It don't come easy. You know it don't come easy.
You always loved Ringo the best, didn't you, Charlie?
I did, Don. I did, especially when he wore the polar bear suit.
Hi, Charlie.
Hello, Don.
Ready for some phone calls?
Yeah, watch out for the wintry mix. I love Ringo, though. He's my favorite monkey.
Let's take your phone call. Here's how you get through.
Yeah.
It's 877-365-3636 from anywhere in America. Canada. I'm pausing now while Mike is turning different shades of blue.
I'm fine.
We're almost to... No, 911!
Yeah, a little chest call.
Canada, 800-636-1067. D.C. 202-432-1067. All right, let's go.
Christ, it was so much fun to visit with Charlie when I was 27.
Hello. Jingles. Don and Mike Show. Hello.
F you, Don, you piece of trash.
No.
Whoa!
Why F me?
Whoa!
I'm not debating I'm a piece of trash, but why start off with F you?
Yeah, trailer park trash, I should say.
She's told before.
I'm trailer park trash. Why am I trailer park trash, darling?
Because you're a big mouth son of a bitch.
Now, what is the deal, lady? Be a little nice.
You too, Mike.
F you.
Why the Red Sox are not going to win the World Series?
And now you're getting personal. That's like talking about my mamo.
You slut.
You bitch.
Lose some weight, fat ass.
Whore. Whore. Get your tubes tied.
At least my mama did not throw me out.
Ah, go shave your back.
Your mama did not throw you out. Your mama said to me today, well, I couldn't really understand what she was saying because...
Hello, Dom. Help me, Dom. Help me.
Her mother was full of my man juice.
What's really troubling you, baby?
Weigh 1,000 pounds, fat ass.
Hey, Buzz, talk to her. Calm her down. We can't make any headway with her.
Listen, darling, talk to me. What's troubling you, baby?
Nothing.
Come on now. There's got to be something on your mind. Why the anger?
See, why does it always work with him?
It's working.
Man, what do you do? Take some drugs? You hippie.
Oh, I guess it didn't work with you either, Buzz.
All right. Sorry about that. Hello. Yeah. Mike Show. Phone scan. Hello.
She's not well.
Come on. Call her a bitch, Buzz. She was. You can say it, Buzz.
She's a mentally ill bitch.
She's a bitch. Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Buzz. Hello. Don and Mike Show. Phone scan.
Crack me up.
Anyone can call. Don and Mike. Hello.
Obviously.
Hello.
Hello?
Yeah, you're on the air. Hi.
Hey, oh, my God. I love you guys. Hello to Don.
Sir, I got to ask you, focus a little bit, okay?
Okay.
You're on the air.
I mean, you're really all over the place.
Here we go. Come on. You're on the air.
Hello to Don. Hello to Mike.
Okay.
Hello to Buzz.
We're all here.
Robbie.
Yeah. How about a point?
Else?
How about a point, sir?
Here we go. Come on.
And,
come on now.
We have,
yeah, you just wanted to be on the radio.
Okay. Well, okay. Then. Hi, Don and Mike Show. Phone stand.
Cake off your face.
Hello.
That's not cake.
You are on the air.
Hello, Don and Mike.
Hi there.
This is Rod Smuts down in Houston. This is football. He hates me. What's up, Don and Mike?
This guy is, okay, I'll tell you what he's trying to do. First, he's trying to do the black thing. He's trying to do the, hey, hello there.
That's best left in the hands of professionals.
And then
right.
He's trying to do Rod Smart, who's He Hate Me, who is the guy from the XFL who played Carolina now.
Yeah, a little old. Quite an old reference there.
Goodbye. Hello, Don and Mike Show.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey, did you guys happen to see that dumb bitch last night on My Big Fat Fiancé?
Yes, I did.
I saw the very tail end.
Did you watch it, Mike?
I saw the tail end of it, and he still makes me laugh when he's coming up the stairs.
He's like, oh, my God, I can't believe you're saying that to me. Would you guys do her if she was your sister?
What are the numbers for that show? Are they any good?
I know they were good the first week.
Okay.
I don't know how good
second
they were.
Second week usually tells, right? Whether for a guy that loved the show... I didn't watch it last night.
They're doing really good 24 to 54 IQ.
Hey! I watched it and...
who says I'm dumb? I'm kidding, of course.
I came across the same absolute be-all, end-all about that show that I had last week. That girl, that teacher, that Catholic school teacher, she can't be that dumb. She can't be that dumb to think when she sits the guy down and has a discussion and says, if you don't get your act together, I'm not going to be able to continue this relationship.
Your point is that even though she's being scammed, you think that anybody with even a reasonable amount of intelligence...
At some point would say, hey, listen...
I point out the fact that she described the kitchen appliance that keeps things cold as a refrigerator?
Hello.
There you go.
Don and Mike phone scan.
Hey, guys, how you doing?
Hey, but what is this? I'm thinking that I don't believe that the girl's that dumb, but I watched it again.
That would wreck it for me if I felt like that. And I can see where you might feel like that. I wouldn't be able to watch it. The guy, you know, the guy in a Belushi way, he kind of makes me laugh.
Yeah, the guy is funny. And
the guy is funny just on his own.
And they've given, like last week, or last night, last week's episode, they gave the guy different stuff to do. They said, now you're going to have to be outrageous and make her mad.
Right.
And then you're going to have to win her back so she doesn't want to... blow this whole thing up, but she never came close to saying at any point, this is too ridiculous for me.
Did you see that next week, though, don't they bring his family in?
They bring a friend of hers in, a friend of her family.
They bring a friend of hers in to meet. Well, that happened at the tail end of the show.
Right.
And she's going to meet him, and then I believe next week she gets to meet his family, and all I saw in the clip is that they're all playing with their food in their mouth. You know, just kind of going,
ow, 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 ow. And please keep in mind, when you are a functioning member of society, refrigerator not nearly as bad as freezer box.
We had that one, too.
Yeah.
Don and Mike, hello, phone scan.
Hello, Radio God.
Howdy.
Hey, coming out from Sacramento, we love you guys. I got two comments. Where's Dennis Murphy been?
Okay, let's move past that one. That's a good thing.
Also, you guys watch Las Vegas, right?
I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mike does.
You watched it last night?
I watched half of it last night.
I did.
Okay, you know the gal that got stuck in the elevator?
Yeah.
Deborah Dean?
She's married to Bob.
Nikki.
She's married to Bobcat Goldthwait. Can you believe that?
You mean the one with the cleavage?
Nikki Cox?
Yeah. She's married to Bobcat Goldthwait.
Wow.
Really? Do you remember how bad Bob Goldthwait looked?
POA.
Do you remember that CSI last year that Bob Goldthwait was on?
Oh.
We both thought that
the comedy, the one about a comedy.
Right, that he looked like heavy time.
Oh, he looked horrible. She's married to him?
Wow.
Yes, he is.
All right, thank you, my friend.
She's one of that show's star POA.
Absolutely.
Hi, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Don and Mike.
Yes.
She's no Molly Sims.
This is the phone scan. Pardon?
I said Radio Gods.
Right, and I said hello, like waiting 8,000 times for you just to say something.
Yeah.
Say something.
Jesus, well, I've been on hold so damn long.
Okay, sorry. We
I thought for a minute that might be a cell phone, when in fact it's the guy going,
hello, Don and Mike, phone scan.
Don and Mike, who would win a fight, Charlie or Larry Bud Melman?
Charlie Suang Stavelak or Larry Bud Melman?
Charlie would
kill him.
He would, literally, he would kill him.
Melman is dead.
Charlie is, Rob is the wrong Charlie.
Oh,
see, that's how you're going to get in trouble with the jingles.
Okay.
Rob came over and like pointing, press the Charlie Broyhill jingle.
It's not Charlie Broyhill.
No, it's not. No. Charlie Suang Stavelak. And now that I think about it, we should have had a jingle made for him.
Charlie Suang Stavelak.
Yeah, we should have had that done.
Oh, what a shame.
Charlie Suang Stavelak.
Whee!
Hello, Don and Mike show.
Where are Busto guys?
Right on. Hi.
Hey, Rob A.
Yeah.
What kind of TV did you get?
46 inch Hitachi.
Oh, sweet. You're going to have a Super Bowl party or whatnot?
Come on. That's a good call.
That is a good call.
And how about my man, Rob?
Yeah.
Buying a Japanese-made TV.
Yeah, hey, secret's out.
There you go. And I thought you were a member, Rob.
Yeah, the image is cracked.
What have I always told you? Know thy enemy.
Hello.
I keep my friends close and my enemies even closer.
He uses it to watch the History Channel.
On Mike show. Hello. This is the phone scan. Hello.
Yes. I am not idiots, gentlemen.
And listen, don't get me wrong here. I'm a hypocrite because I have a fantastic Japanese television, Sony TV. It's fantastic. But the thing is, I know from the Reverend Reggie White that's what the Japanese people are good at. They can take a TV.
Put it on your watch.
Put it on your wrist.
Yeah, absolutely.
Put it right on your wrist. Yeah, hi there. What can we do for you?
Oh, he gave up.
Oh, and he said something that Joe Theismann said to us.
Don, Mike, both of you, idiots.
Remember after we played that tape, we had a tape where Mike said,
"Yep,
I'm not idiots," or something like that, gentlemen.
Yeah, we can't blame Joe for knowing the facts.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Hello.
Don and Mike.
Hi, folks. Again.
How's it going, fellas?
It's going pretty well.
Rock on. You guys are the best show ever. You guys kick so much ass. I can't even...
Yeah.
Begin to describe how...
Well, go ahead. You can't say the F word. The guy says, you're so effing funny.
Yeah.
Oh, my. Get out of here.
And
here's the original quote from Mike.
I'm not idiots, gentlemen.
I'm not idiots, gentlemen. I was having just one of those little baby strokes that I have every now and then.
Hello.
You were having a day.
Don and Mike show.
Michael.
Yes, sir.
What did you enjoy for lunch today?
I fried me up some buffalo wings.
Delicious.
Fantastic. Donald? With no carbohydrates in the hot sauce.
Mmm. Donald? Don Geronimo.
Mm. As always, fresh placenta.
Yum, yum.
Liz, were you or were you not at Hershey Park this summer?
I was at Hershey Park this summer.
I saw you in your tight black shirt.
Oh, I forgot.
Did
you find my glasses?
I did. It was 95 degrees that day, sir.
It was. Yes, it was a hot day.
Hold on. Listen, what do I hear? Oh, that's right, a new caller. Hi, Don and Mike show. Phone scan.
Hey, Don, Mike.
Yeah.
What's up, guys? Hey, I just wanted to say about the Oakland Raiders got one of the Redskins.
Thank you. Yes. Once again, we're traveling back in time to yesterday's show when we did cover the fact that our friend, Norv Turner, is the new coach of your Oakland Raiders.
That was a big story yesterday.
On this show.
But I like the way he told it.
Right there, Don and Mike show.
Hey, Don, hey, Mike, how's it going?
This is not Dennis.
That's too low a voice for the Dennis Murphy impression.
No, I know. Hey, Mike.
Yes.
Hey, are you guys going to go to Jeopardy anyway on Friday?
Yes, we are going to do Low Budget Jeopardy.
We're going to have the football Santa?
The football Santa?
Oh, you mean John Madden?
Yeah, I know you guys hate that, but man, you got to have it, dude.
No, listen, we got something special for Friday, for Jeopardy Friday from the Super Bowl.
I am stealing myself for an afternoon of complete humiliation.
It's going to be good. Friday from Houston.
All right.
The Jeopardy will be outstanding Friday.
Yeah.
Hello, Don and Mike's show.
Hello.
Hi, you're on the air.
Hey.
I only pray Jim Gray stops by during the segment.
Oh, yeah.
How are you? Hello, Don and Mike's show. Phone scan.
He's crazy.
You know what your problem is? Well, I'll have to tell you while you listen to the radio is that you were born. I'm sorry. Listen,
come on.
You can't sit there. Oh, you're still there.
Me?
Yeah, I thought I just hung up on you. Hello, Don and Mike show. You can't listen to the radio. You got to listen to the phone. Hello, Don and Mike.
Hello?
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 Yeah, you're on the air. Hi.
Oh, hey, sorry. There's no way to tell if you're on the air or not.
But you heard us say hello.
That's not true.
No, but I can hear everybody say hello.
Why?
There's silence.
We brought it up before. I do listen to radio of all different kinds, especially talk radio.
It's the whoosh factor.
F is wrong with our lines here, our callers?
There you go. The problem is not with...
How come it's absolutely seamless? Who's giving them the instructions?
No instruction. The thing is, I've been saying hello to every caller before me.
Cell phone.
It's real simple. When you call the show and you get on the air, you hear a whoosh, and then you hear you're on the air.
Mm-hmm.
I hear nothing like that.
I have called a satellite show of this program on the weekends, and I'm never...
A spinoff show.
Yes. I have never been confused when it's time for me to participate in a wedding show.
I've called up for shows before and not had a problem knowing that you were on the air. There was some, like, wait to tell.
Honey, listen, okay, I'm very sorry that you can't that you're on the air, but now that you're on the air, what can we do for you?
I just wanted to call and tell you guys that I love your show and you make me laugh every day.
Well, that was nice.
Thank you very much. See, it's very hard to come back and say something
awful.
You're
disarmed.
Yeah, she says something very nice.
Well, I just wanted to call and say that you've got a big fan.
Blow it out your bum.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Someone had to.
She did. You know what? You said it. She didn't even hear it, though.
Yeah.
You said blow it out your bum.
She was too busy not listening.
Hello, Don and Mike show. Phone scan. Hello.
Hey, guys.
Hey.
Hey, how about Alec Baldwin, huh? Getting nominated for Best Actor and Worst Actor.
Yeah, you know, and I think he deserves it for the Kula.
Did he get nominated?
Yes, he did.
Really?
Yeah. There's not a chance he wins, but he did get nominated, yeah.
I didn't see it, but... Did you guys see Glengarry Glen Ross?
Oh, he's great.
Sure. Of course.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the best ever.
Yeah, I think that's probably his very best role.
ABC, always be close.
And you know that, what's the movie that when he says, I am God? Do you remember the name of that movie?
Oh,
I believe
yeah.
That that's not The Jury.
No, it's not The Jury.
More.
Is it Malice?
No. Malice.
Malice.
Mm-hmm. Malice.
Well, who do you think you are, God?
I am God.
I understand if Alec Baldwin wins the Oscar, he's going to eat it.
He is looking big.
Hey, Don and Mike show, phone scan. Hello.
I heard the hush, heard the whoosh.
Right, see, it ain't tough.
What can we do for you?
Exactly. Calling from Spokane, I've got an update on one of Buzz's news stories from a couple days ago.
All right. Very good.
Two guys from Spokane streaked into Denny's, had their car stolen, bought their clothes in the car.
I remember what happened.
Supposedly not tonight. Tomorrow they're going to be on Jay Leno. So that's the update for the twink to be on TV.
All right, thank you, my friend. Hello, Don and Mike show.
Hey, Bueno Arbusto again, Radio God.
Good update.
Yeah.
There goes their careers.
Hello, you're on the air.
Hey, check this out. My wife and I were on the beach this weekend down in Southern California, and this huge black Suburban pulls up, and these bunch of guys walked out with umbrellas, and of course you could probably think, okay, it's Michael Jackson, right?
Right.
And they walk up next to us, and it is Michael Jackson, and my wife turns and says, excuse me, sir, you're in my son.
Oh, now, you know, that's cheating.
That's cheating, but...
You're a bad, bad listener.
And yet good.
You're a bad...
Might have won.
You're not allowed to call with jokes.
We've got to give him a pass because I'm not sure if it's spotlighted as a joke and we didn't think it was a legitimate story, we might not have laughed as hard.
It did make us laugh.
It did make us laugh.
All right, get out of here. You get a pass.
Give me something good then.
Give me something good. How about my finger right there on another line? Hello, Don and Mike show.
You're in the no-spin zone. What say
you, Don.
Stop it, O'Reilly. Oh, hello, God. Don Mike, your phone scan.
Hi, Don Mike.
Hi.
It's not tricky. I know I'm on the air. That tell that dumb seed to never call back again. What's the matter with her?
Right on. Thank you. Hey, what's the matter with her?
Hey, come on. What's the matter with her?
Don and Mike, hello.
Radio.
Right, phone screen. Hello, hi. I'm sorry, that's a bad line. Got to take another one. Don and Mike, hello.
Hey, guys, you cannot overuse Bacardi Limon.
Bacardi Limon.
And
they sent today, both Mike and I, a huge box full of product,
ooh,
which we have decided to send up to Chief Engineer Tony.
Tony gets both gift baskets from the people at Bacardi.
Bacardi Limon.
Very nice.
Amen. Now, why is it when we talk about something that you and I really don't care for?
Right.
I mean, not that we've got anything against Bacardi Limon.
Bacardi Limon.
But we talk about it, and they send a box of it.
Right.
Meanwhile, we talk about stuff all the time on this show.
Very good.
We never get sent any free stuff from those guys.
No, and especially, well, the new sponsor, the Coca-Cola Bottling Company, who, you know, really should send along something for you.
It's called Diet Vanilla Coke.
Yeah, and then, well, see, I'm not ready to commit to that soft drink that they sent me the prototype of. I mean, it's like I'm going to drink it all the time.
I don't want to say I told you so, but...
Well, no, I mean, I'd like to try it again. I'd like to try it on over ice and see what it tastes like.
The Diet Coke with lime?
Yeah, Diet Coke with lime. I like it, you know, I like it just fine.
What did I...
And maybe they could use that on there.
Yeah, they should.
I like it just fine.
That was a bad line. Hello, Don and Mike.
Mike O'Mara?
What?
I cannot believe you endorsed a general for president. You warmonger, you disgusting man, dead babies dying in the streets. How dare you, sir? How dare you? I shall never listen again.
Okay. Thank you. Do we have a final caller here?
Thank you.
Hello. Don and Mike, hello.
You're my son.
Hello.
Don and Mike.
Right.
Hey, I just want to tell you guys, you changed my life.
Okay, thanks. How?
The whatnot alert. I've instituted in my own home people to come up with a whatnot to band.
The whatnot, okay.
From his house.
And that's the last.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah, you're a winner. Even though the music ran out, you're the winner. What's your name, my friend?
My name's Keith. I'm calling from Reno.
Right on. Keith, you've won the Lara Croft Tomb Raider Cradle of Life prize pack. Enjoy Lara Croft Tomb Raider Cradle of Life on the Comcast cable in the band pay-per-view for your chance to win a room full of furniture from Ashley Furniture.
Oh. Hmm.
Thank you, my friend. Hold on.
Thanks, guys. You rock.
Thank you very much for listening in Reno.
Wonderful.
Got a break. Now, we're super bold absolutely to the max this week because we're going to the game on Friday. We're going to broadcast from Houston.
What, this Friday?
Yes, this Friday, Mike. You know that. I know you got the email.
All right.
I know you got it.
Okay, and, I'm sure I did.
And we did a wacky Super Bowl interview earlier in the show today.
Uh-huh.
Really, listen for it in a couple of weeks on Best Of. That's how good it is. How really good.
You're
going to
love it. Yeah, that guy was a dick.
when we come back, we're going to try something with us first and maybe... You guys can call in, and if you can get this going, you win $100. If not, we'll try it among ourselves first. We're going to call the sex lines, the dialing for transvestite lines. Call the shemale number. Who can do, out of you guys listening, who can do the best Jim Nantz, and who can make the man/woman on the other end of the sex line accept the fact that you're Jim Nantz?
Mm-hmm.
Now, remember how Jim Nantz talks.
Mm-hmm.
It's...
Hey, my radio buddies, Don and Mike.
Hey, Don and Mike, it's me, Jim Nantz. Now, here's a bunch of tapes of the real Jim Nantz.
Absolutely.
There he is. Here's
absolutely.
Here's another one.
You go with me. I've got a plane.
Okay, here's another one.
How about after we get finished with the broadcast, you come with me to the CBS party?
You know Jimmy's on the NFL.
He's a classic announcer guy.
He's on our show all the time.
How about you come to the game with me? You sit on the CBS set, the Superdome. I'll take good care of it. Best seats in the house.
Here he is, Jim Nantz. Here's another one.
And I like what you just said. Do you mind if I maybe stole that and use that on the broadcast?
Okay, he's on fire.
Jim Nantz is on fire today!
So,
and who was it that said that?
As Mike O'Malley, I think.
Mike O'Malley, right.
The other guy, the gay guy that pretends that he's not.
Right.
You guys have been unbelievable.
Thank you, Jimbo. And are you proud?
Trying to make you proud, guys. Was that okay?
Yeah, that's it.
That's good, Jim Nantz.
You hear him on the show every week. So basically what we're looking for, and we'll all give it a try first. I'm not even saying it's going to get to you guys.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That maybe... We'll just use it all the time doing it ourselves to see who can be the best.
I'm wearing quite a nice dress right now, and I'm almost all the way there. I've got the boobs done and waiting for the package to be delivered.
Hi there, it's Jim Nantz calling you from Houston, Texas, Reliance Stadium. All I'm wearing right now is a dickie.
That's right.
Just a turtleneck, a mock turtleneck, a dickie.
And my artificial breasts. because I am becoming a woman.
I'm Jim Nantz. Please call me Nancy James.
Yeah, wearing a fedora, boys. Yeah, a woman in a hat, so vogue.
Want to jump into a hot tub with my radio buddies, Don and Mike?
Buzz, give it a try. Give the Jim Nantz a try. Come on now.
My radio buddies, Don and Mike.
Hey.
Just that. Not an in-person.
I know, you're not. You're funny.
Michael Elton is Buzz Burbank.
That's who I am.
You're funny.
400 people dead of exposure.
I'll tell you, they're taking quite a chance with that New England game.
So it's
should have started that at noon down in Miami.
Dialing for Transvestites as Jim Nantz. We'll start it. If we have time, we'll include you guys. We'll be back in less than 10 minutes.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
All right, welcome back, everybody, and again, happy Thanksgiving from all of us here at the NFL today. Now, the IBM Power Poll, this picked by my guys here as always, Craig, Randy, Gary, Eric, Mann, Bob, Matina, our radio buddies, Don and Mike, everybody in on this
the
one.
The Don and Mike Show.
They wear a lot of hats while they sit on the fence making a commitment. Don and Mike.
When we're in Houston on Friday for the Super Bowl show, they're all coming by. Boomer Esiason, Dan Marino.
Wow.
Jim Gray, Bonnie Bernstein, Nancy James. They're all coming by to be on the show. And, of course, the highlight for us is going to be meeting with Jim Nantz again.
Jim Nantz, always a pleasure. And last time we were, I think, the Final Four.
Right.
He kind of gave us exclusivity. Whisked into the press room and whisked right out.
And won't he be happy to know that we have got a segment on the show where we're going to be spotlighting Jim Nantz. Let's dial for phone whores.
It's time for dialing for transvestites with Robin.
And everybody.
As his alter ego of Dolores, and to get the minds of all guys.
Now remember, we got to pay attention here at the very beginning to figure out how we get back to the main menu.
Always tricky.
We're each going to get 60 seconds, okay?
Ooh, how do you feel about getting the entire package? And I mean everything.
Sure.
Ooh, with me, you can have it both ways.
Yeah.
All at the same time.
Thank you.
I certainly find it convenient. The question is, can you? You think you're a man enough, and you're over 18. Let's get it on.
Well, I need the last four digits of our phone number, Robbie.
For only $1.99 to $4.99 per minute. For customer service, call
1-800-777-1449. Mike, it's the real she-males line.
Gotcha.
Each call has an access fee of $5.99.
Each one.
Please be aware that your call may be monitored.
We just have to figure out what it is to get out of one
Please.
Guy and into another. What, if it's pound?
Here we go.
Oh, I got to tell them they're on the air. This is how it works.
I'm here to connect you to one of my friends. Can you please verify the last four digits of your phone number?
Hey, Don and Mike Show, you're on the air. And it's 0781. Now I got to tell the next person.
To go one-on-one with hot cross-dressers, transvestites, and she-males.
Right.
One. Only $4.99 per minute.
No problem.
Press 2 to join the nationwide TVTS conference. Only $4.49 per minute.
You want to press 1,
Press
right?
3 to speak live with other hot callers. Only $3.99 per minute.
I think one-on-one.
Remember, to get back to the main menu, you can press star at any time.
Star. Okay, and 60 seconds on the clock. Just got to tell them that they're on the air.
Why do I go first? You go ahead.
I'll probably peter out halfway through.
Okay.
Hi, this is Tori. Who's this?
You're on the air. This is Jim.
Hi, Jim. How are you, sweetie?
I'm doing... pardon me? Jim Nantz here? This is Jim Nantz?
Is what, baby?
My name is Jim Nantz. However, I want to be known as Nancy James. I want to say hi to my radio buddies, Don and Mike. I'm wearing a fedora. I'm wearing a dicky, and I'm wearing nothing else right now. Do me. Would you please say Jim Nantz is a pretty girl?
Jim, what's the last name?
Nantz.
Man?
Nantz, you bitch. Jim Nantz. Say Jim Nantz is a pretty girl.
Jim Nantz is a pretty girl.
Right here on CBS. Say CBS. Say it.
Yes.
Say it. Now call me by my girl name, Nancy James.
Nancy James.
Nancy James. Say, do you like football? Do you like the pigskin?
Sure, baby.
Do you like the offense going down the field and penetrating?
Oh,
man. My time is up.
Go one-on-one with hot cross-dressers.
Ready, Mike?
I'm ready.
She-males, press 1. okay. Only $4.99 per minute. Press 2 to join the nationwide TVTS conference.
You got to tell her you're on
the air. Back to the main menu. You can press star at any time.
Get warmed up.
Oh, two rings. Hope it's not the same shemale.
Hello there.
Don and Mike, you're on the air.
Hi, who's this?
Who is this?
Gina, it's Jim Nantz from CBS Sports. How are you?
I'm fine. What are you up to, Jim?
What I'm up to is just trying to relieve some of this stress. I'll tell you, with the big game coming up this Sunday, I'm under a great deal of pressure right here, and I was wondering if we could have some intimate one-on-one chat.
Well, it's not one-on-one, baby. It's an open line, and anyone can step in at any time.
Well, that's okay. I want to talk to you. What's your name again? Can you give it to me one more time, please?
My name is Gina.
Gina, I'm Jim. Jim Nantz. I don't know if you're familiar with my work on CBS Sports. I am the host of the pregame show for the NFL today.
I'm sorry.
Are you familiar with the NFL? Do you follow sports, Gina?
Hey, look, I'm pissed off because the Bucks aren't in, okay?
Not a girl, Gina. Talk to me. Gina, is there a chance, while I got you on the line here, we could do some cuddling?
Sure, baby.
Could you put your arms around my neck right now and hold me tight like you love me?
Oh, yeah.
I'm Jim Nantz from CBS Sports, and I'll tell you, can you do something? Can you repeat after me and say, Jim Nantz,
5 seconds.
You're my main man?
I can't say that, baby.
Please, baby, can you do it for me?
No.
Oh, you bitch. Thank you.
Buzz, are you ready?
Yes.
Stressors, transvestites, and shemales.
Remember, to get back to the main menu, you can press star at any time.
All right, give me a second here.
Okay.
I got to start the show there.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go. Or you can say that, Buzz. I don't care what she says. Hello, just say you're on the air.
Okay.
I mean, he. What am I saying? She.
She, he. How can you tell?
Penis.
Do they have penises? Oh, yeah,
one
females.
One with hot cross-dressers, transvestites, and shemales. Press 1.
Yeah, okay. That's what we wanted.
Remember to get back to the main menu.
Hi, baby.
You can press star at any time.
Hi, baby.
Come on. Come on. Pick up. How does any guy or any girl or...
Hello.
You're on the air. You're on the air.
Hi. Who is this?
Hi. This is Jerry.
This is Jim Nantz on CBS. Do you watch the iNetwork?
Oh, yeah.
I'm on it all the time.
Nice.
Have you seen the movie trailers? I'm in the theaters.
Nice.
You know, Cuba Gooding Jr. is a friend of mine. Have you seen the movie Radio? Have you seen me on Yes, Dear? It's Jim Nantz here.
Hi.
Hi.
You're not getting much out of her.
How
much.
Are you?
I'm good.
Good stuff.
Good.
Though.
I'd like you to tell me I'm a pretty girl.
Oh, you are a pretty girl.
Pretty tense down here in Houston, getting ready for the big game.
Nice.
I'd like it if you'd call me Nancy James. Do you mind?
Nancy James?
My real name's Jim Nantz on CBS.
Nice.
But I'd like you to call me Nancy James.
Okay, Nancy James.
Thank you, buddy.
Get down on your knees, baby.
Hey.
My little Nancy.
Buzz, my winner in those.
Whatever you say.
Hey, that's more than we got. Way to go,
step
Buzz.
Up, wow. Step up, Rob.
One with hot cross-dressers transvestites.
Wow, I really am on my knees.
For a ticket back to the main menu, man. You can press star.
She wanted you down. PC wanted you on your knees.
And Buzz, way to go. Bring in the movie Radio in. I should have done that. Damn. You ready, Robbie?
Yeah.
Here we go. When she says hello, tell her she's on the air.
Hi, this is Tori. Who's this?
You're on the air with Jim Nantz. Hello.
Hello. Are we doing this again, dear?
Oh, yes. Oh. I missed you. I did. Okay. It's tough being the eyes and the ears of the Columbia Broadcasting System.
What station are you with, dear?
What's that?
Are you with an actual radio station?
Columbia Broadcasting System.
Columbia Broadcasting System.
Look at me. I have hard shoes and a scarf and a hat. I wear a lot of makeup, eyeliner. Do you know how cold it is? Hundreds of people could die from exposure. Sing to me. Sing me the theme to All in the Family. Can you do that?
I think about it for a minute.
You remember All the Way Glenn Miller played? Sing it. Sing it loud so Boomer can hear. What's that?
Do I get a prize for this?
Your prize is in my pocket.
Oh, my.
I'm Jim Nantz. Very good.
Okay, and now
I like that.
One-on-one with hot cross.
Someone from the telephone.
Someone from the phone.
Excellent. I think we all did what we could do.
Right.
The question now for you on the telephone.
Yes, conference.
Can you do a little better?
Let's see what happens.
Let's go to
live with other hot callers. Only 3 minutes.
Hi, Brian.
Press 4 to hear erotic confessions.
Hey, Brian.
Tales,
yeah.
Love.
Dude, where are you from?
Placerville, California.
Brian, are you drunk?
No, this is Jim Nantz, CBS.
All right, hold on. I'm going to press the button. I got to tell her she's on the air. He's on the air. Then you're on your own.
Good luck.
Make it happen.
Get back to the main menu. You can press star at any time.
Hey, baby.
Good luck, Jim.
Good luck from Jim. From all the gyms.
All the gyms.
AJ's, all the gyms. ATJ's.
Hello.
Don and Mike.
Hello, Jim Nantz, CBS Sports.
Hi.
How are you?
Oh, I'm good, baby. How are you?
I'm doing as good as a stroll up the azalea-lined fairways of Augusta National.
Nice. You're a funny man, aren't you?
Oh, pretty serious. About as serious as that snow in Foxborough last week. Did you see that?
No, I didn't.
No.
I don't watch the news.
Well, I'm with CBS Sports. You might know me. Jim Nantz.
No, it doesn't ring a bell. I'm sorry.
Is there a way?
That's okay.
You guys doing better than we do.
He is.
The other network.
I don't watch sports, darling, but it's all right.
Well, what kind of sports do you like? Do you like that kind of sport?
Bad kind of sport.
Say that again?
Do you like that kind of sport? The fun sport, if you get my drift?
Oh, those are the kind of sports.
Oh, started out strong.
Hold on, we've moved to pasture. Hold on,
the azalea lane.
Brian, that was good. Hold on, we're going to give one more guy a chance.
And bringing the Masters into it really, really made it for me.
Hey, Richard?
Yeah.
Don't hide from your feelings. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm trying.
All right. Where are you from, Richard?
Baltimore City.
Right on. Live 105. Wait for me to tell her she's on the. You're on the air. She's on the air. He's on the air.
Whatever. Listen to him breathing. Christ.
You know it ain't easy.
You know how hard it can be. You know it don't come easy.
The way things are going.
One-on-one with hot cross.
Remember to get back to the main menu. You can press star at any time.
We're going to have a little exposure there.
Okay, come on, baby. Hi, baby.
Hi, baby. Hi, baby.
Jesus. God, you're on the
Hello,
air.
Hello, this is Jim Nantz. I'm from CBS Sports. You're on the air. I was wondering what you're wearing over there.
That's just terrible.
Hello?
This guy stays on
Hello? Hello?
Hi, baby.
Is there anyone there? It's Jim Nantz.
So bad he chased her away.
Hello?
She hung up.
Wow.
She hung up.
Wow.
Incredible.
She hung up.
Hang up. You suck.
There you go.
God.
But in a great way.
God, you're awful.
Hi, baby.
You're awful. We do have a Jim Nantz winner.
Very good.
He sounds a little like Tom Gavin when Tom Gavin does a mimic
voice. Absolutely. We do have a Jim Nantz winner. It's Brian. Hi, Brian. Or hold on a second. That's Chris. There, Chris. Brian.
Yes, this is Brian.
You're the guy that did the good one, right?
Walking the
Azalea line fairway.
Yeah. That rock. Yeah. Yes, correct. listen, congratulations. $100 for you.
Thank you.
And the Lara Croft Tomb Raider Cradle of Life prize pack. And a chance to win a room full of furniture from Ashley Furniture. Pretty good. I mean,
bravo.
We did our best, but you... you outdid us with the talk about the Azaleas.
That was it. I mean, just going to the Masters. That was the wild card. Good job.
Well, thank you.
All right, my friend.
I thought about bringing Billy Packard into it, but I didn't. You know.
See, there's a guy thinking more than we did.
Sure.
I should have thought about that. About
Billy Packard, right?
Packard, I hardly knew her.
Do you know Billy Packard?
All right, so you said, not that it really matters in the big scheme of things, you said you're from California, but it says on the screen you're from Lake Tahoe.
Well, Placerville, which is between Sacramento and Lake Tahoe.
Yeah, pretty part of the country.
All right, so what is if you had to choose, because we don't have an affiliate in Placerville.
Yeah, would you be a Reno guy or would you be a Sacramento guy?
I would be a guy from that which you do the dance.
All right. Hey, way to go. Well, you done the city proud.
Don't worry. We ain't taking your prize away.
Yeah, okay. It's pretty obvious you're not really from there.
No.
If I was you, I'd just based on our conversation,
sure.
You know, how to win friends and influence people, tell them you're from Reno.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's why, usually with Joe, I just say I'm from South Lake Tahoe area.
Yeah, it's Lake Tahoe. That's nice.
But he spent enough time there to answer by saying that of which you do the dance.
Yeah.
All right, thank you. Hey, good job.
Hey, thank you very much.
You cracked us up. Thank you.
All right. Hey, by the way,
yeah.
Shout out to Bo and Scott and all Charlie all day sometime.
All Charlie all day.
Now, you mean...
Get to know Charlie.
You mean that Charlie, right?
Yes.
Right.
Very good.
Not that
Charlie Boy here.
Not that Charlie.
Not that Charlie.
In a world where he's the bad radio man. Was strictly forbidden, one man found a way to bring good news to his people.
Oh, darn.
He made it up.
Why is Charlie the bad man?
He's mean.
Why?
I can't tell you on the radio.
What he did to you, right?
Many times.
What is your lead story on
with his hand
today?
Today, drug bust. On the set of Friends.
Ooh.
All right.
How you doing?
That's Joey.
Stay tuned for news and comment coming up on the Don and Mike Show.
We both love Joey, don't
He's
we?
He's the best.
We'll be right back. That was all very...
I don't know.
...professional. News and comments. Buzz brought to you by Veramax Sexual Pleasure. Performance enhancer.
Someone call for a doctor.
Doctor developed, clinically tested. Veramax works. Get it at Rite Aid, GMC, other select retailers. Try it today. Veramax 1-888. Try VMAX. And now here is Buzz as they try to figure out. Are we back on the air on WJFK?
We're back. Excellent.
Hi, on WJFK.
Hi there. How are you? Hey, good to be with you.
Hi, Don and Mike.
Hi, Buzz.
Hi.
That's cool. The people didn't get to hear that.
Yeah,
on
they should.
Okay, because we were off the air because of bad weather or something.
Dig those drums.
Anyway, that was me.
Mm-hmm. Don.
Don Geronimo.
Yeah, Don right. Presses all the buttons here. Unlike me, I'm over here on the other
side. Michael Mara.
That's you.
And yeah. Then away from the show, I'm...
Michael Soares.
Right, and now we're going to go to...
Michael Elton as Buzz Burbank.
Right.
Bingo.
There you
Hi.
Go.
Hi. And, hey, you don't want to leave out the guy that's standing in back of you.
Buzz be whack.
Or those two guys that are back in the producer's room. The
Hold on. There's the dumb guy.
Joe Arnger.
But then there's the other dumb guy.
Charlie Boy here.
There it is.
Go figure. They have jingles, too.
Mm-hmm.
Bacardi Limon.
Hello.
Hi, Buzz.
Hello, everyone with and without jingles. In Hollywood, when they say we're rolling, who knows what they mean? Two suspected drug dealers were arrested on the Warner Brothers lot in Los Angeles this week, just a few feet away from the set of the hit TV show Friends.
Oh, you're teased. See how you did that?
I did.
Well, you're teased. I thought Matthew Perry was going up the river again.
You made us think it was one of our friends.
We don't know yet. It's too early to tell.
How are you doing?
And the ER set is just around the corner. The two men were handcuffed.
Well, it's got to be Anthony Edwards, though.
He's dead, isn't he?
Was he still on the show?
He was in fact. He's not on the show anymore, but he was in Fast Times, so I consider him a suspect.
I always look at that guy and think, okay, yeah, that's a pothead.
You think he's a stoner?
Yeah, oh, absolutely.
Really? Okay.
And on Friends, let me guess, of the six friends.
If it was pot. If it was pot. All right.
Stoner?
Mm-hmm.
Now, there's the most obvious one, Courtney Cox, because of David Arquette, because you got to think that he probably gets stoned all the time.
Mm-hmm. I would think, for just the way he looks, Schwimmer.
Oh, no, I don't think so.
No.
I would go with Big Dumb Joey.
You think it was Joey?
And or Phoebe.
Or Matthew Perry, because of his history.
Yeah, but he's
just
shown...
one little fatty before we tape.
Yeah, but he's shown that that's not his drug of choice. He's like Rush Limbaugh.
He's a Vicodin.
Right? He likes the pills.
That's what he liked, yeah.
I'd say probably Phoebe, because she always seems to be high. And Joey, just because he's, you know.
How you doing? And, you know, it does make sense with the Hollywood, if you're going to do that. You know, hey, bring them to me. You know, bring the drugs to me.
I always keep my eye on the guy who plays Monica's dad, Elliot Gould.
Rightly so. And was great in Ocean's 11. These two men who were arrested, they were handcuffed in front of a group of actors and producers for allegedly selling cocaine and marijuana to people on the lot. Police won't say if any major celebrities were involved yet. They will say it was a... a two-month-long investigation, and that they did get help with that investigation from people who work at the studio. Although Friends has filmed its final episode, there's still a post-series special to be produced on that set. A
lot of tight sphincters in Hollywood.
And don't forget that the night that that runs, whenever that last show runs in May, they're going to be on Jay Leno's show directly afterwards, and Jay Leno's show will really be live that night, and everybody's hoping...
It's Jay Leno. I don't care if they did a little blow.
Everybody's hoping that they're going to be drunk like the people who Cheers were drunk when they were on The Tonight Show.
Oh, hi.
Look for puffy eyes.
No matter as long as my ratings go up. My ratings.
Rush Limbaugh's lawyer says there's nothing unusual about 8.5 powerful pain pills a day for someone with chronic back pain.
Stay cool. Stay cool.
Cabbage, 8.5. Oh, if they only knew it was 8,000 a day.
Baby blues.
Roy Black says that was Rush's average when he was taking Vicodin and OxyContin.
And, you know, I find it incredibly...
Do the numbers. That's not his average.
I just find it incredibly weird that the guy that's defending Rush Limbaugh, Roy Black,
right,
the guy who's, you know, trying to save his career, he has the time to be an expert on the Today Show about the Kobe Bryant case.
Pretty amazing. Sure.
Now, wouldn't you think that when the guy, you know, the guy...
You'd think he'd be off the TV for a while, concentrating on the Rush Limbaugh.
No. Yeah, but no, he's like all the lawyers, you know, that it's not enough that he's with Rush Limbaugh and that he's got his face on TV.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking? That it's really not that, you know, no matter how high-ranking the client is, they're just meat. They're meat.
That's right.
That's it.
It's a way for me to get on television.
And I, you know, if
Kobe Bryant.
See, I can never hold myself totally responsible if the client is found guilty. Rusty.
It's my job as an attorney to everyone deserves a defense.
That's right. I have to present the defense in the best way.
Would I represent Saddam Hussein? I'm afraid I would have to.
He is entitled to a jury trial. Mm. Like anyone else would be.
Rush is not addicted to the pills. I'm here to talk about Kobe Bryant.
He averaged 8.5 a day. Not an unusual number, as far as I'm concerned.
This is Roy Black.
Rusty's lawyer, Roy Black.
Black doesn't sound... Have you seen him on court?
Hi, Roy Black.
He's nothing like... Right. He's nothing like that.
Not at all.
Not at all.
How are you?
Hi, this is Roy Black.
I'm Roy Black, and 8.5 pills a day is the national average.
Good morning, Katie. How are you? Good morning, Matthew.
Good to see you. Yes, I have the time to talk to you. Roy's also blasting the prosecutor for releasing the details of the various plea bargaining proposals. No official charges have been filed against the beleaguered blowhard, but the prosecutor says Limbaugh could face 10 felonies.
What do you call him there, Buzz?
The beleaguered blowhard.
Oh, very good.
The beleaguered blowhard. Listen, I ask you, what is 8.5 pills a day?
Really? I mean, my God, you could have that at breakfast.
You know what that is? That's average.
That's average. That's something to help you get through your day.
Average. Now, Katie, Matt, let's talk about Kobe.
I have the time. I know this. I know the 10 pills a day is a hassle.
No, it was 8 pills a day.
That's right. That is a hassle.
It was 8 pills a day.
For the herpes pills, right?
Uh-huh. What he's been through. Penthouse Magazine, unable to compete with internet porn, is taking a new approach.
What?
This is big. This is landmark stuff.
Okay.
Penthouse is dropping the water sports and the gyno cam. In fact, everything hardcore about Penthouse will disappear, including, apparently, guys' things.
Well, now, listen, I just want to say I'm all for a removal of guys' things.
Mm-hmm. Well, but, I mean, what are they doing?
Because when you buy Penthouse, you're not necessarily buying Penthouse to see man-on-woman sex. Penthouse is, at least when I was growing up and even now as I stand here, you want to see naked chicks, right?
Yeah, but I don't mind. I don't mind Penthouse going a little hardcore, it had become very hardcore, complete with penetration and bodily fluids and all of those things.
Mm-hmm.
And all of those things are now going away.
That's all you want. You just want the pink.
Right? No, I want everything.
Well, I don't want the purple. I just want the pink.
I want everything. I want real porn in my penthouse. Medium rare, then, for you. The magazine says that this fall it will become a new version of what it was in the 1980s. An investment group has committed $85 million to keep the magazine alive. $50 million will go to the makeover. The rest will go to paying off debt.
So what's it going to be, like Maxim?
A little stronger than that. Almost unbelievably, by the way, this whole plan was approved in bankruptcy court yesterday. Penthouse.
Bob Guccione.
Hi, Bob.
One of the first impressions I did on the Don and Mike show was of Bob Guccione.
Oh.
I advised Bob after reading the periodical. I said, Bob.
Yes.
And let's get rid of all of the shafts.
How much money can you get me?
How much do you need? How much is there?
$85 million.
Done and done.
Done and done.
Done and done.
All right, let me get on the phone. Take out the showers. Take out the man things. And let's do it.
And what are your thoughts on Kobe?
On Kobe, I have to watch the Today Show and watch Roy Black.
I am Roy Black.
Oh, I'm sorry. How are you?
Penthouse has apparently also been hurt by super softcore magazines like Maxim. Penthouse hopes the new tasteful, sensual photos will give men what they're not seeing in Maxim and Stuff.
Tell the editors, no balls. I don't want balls in my magazine.
That comes from the lawyer. No balls, please. No balls.
Done and done.
No testicles. Thank you.
Christina Aguilera says she's bisexual.
She was a whore.
Oh, yeah. In fact, she says she likes women more than men.
I say prove it.
She says she really wanted to kiss Britney Spears at the MTV Awards, but she says Britney wanted no part of that.
Yuck.
Christina, you know, yes?
Well, no, you go ahead. I'll tell you this. I thought that had some promise until I heard that you wanted to kiss Britney at the awards.
Well, I think now I think the whole thing's probably just BS. Well, I think Britney and Madonna were just goofing, you know, that was for the press that they, in fact, got.
Well, they
for
were
it. Something in I Cannes, think, France, you know, where they were hugging and kissing again. I think Christina wants in on that action.
See, the thing about the Madonna kiss with Britney Spears that I still don't dig is the fact that you know it was premeditated.
Right, right.
That it's a career move by the ultimate manipulator, Madonna, who's the best at it,
right.
And Britney Spears, who needs some of that.
Mm-hmm.
So if it had happened and it was totally spontaneous, even if Madonna had thought of it and not told Britney Spears,
right,
and then she kissed her, it would be apparent Britney Spears would go, wow, what's going on? But you'd go, okay, this is a moment. You know they got together, or even worse, they didn't get together and their representative said, okay, you know.
Hey, it's a great marketing ploy.
How about this? They kissed. And what bothers me about this now is that Christina Aguilera, you know, if she wants to be bisexual,
like she wasn't invited to the party and she wants to be in the party. Or is she just exceptionally horny?
Hello, Madonna. And this is Roy Black. I represent Britney Spears.
What about a tongue kiss?
On the MTV Awards.
There you are. Christina tells Zoo Magazine, I find it hornier looking at women.
Zoo Magazine?
Yes, Zoo Magazine. The Zoo Magazine.
Zoo Magazine. Let's talk to the editor of Zoo Magazine.
Hello, this is Scott Shannon.
The Zoo Master.
Shannon in the morning.
We got too many jingles now.
That's a good jingle. Quoting it is. They're all good. Christina tells Zoo Magazine, I find it hornier looking at women than men. I love experimenting with my sexuality. If that means girls, then so be it. I have casual sex. I love casual sex. But that doesn't mean I'm incapable of keeping my legs together, end quote.
Mm. Oh, I like that quote.
Yeah, but I, not to like.
And I like Christina Aguilera. Yeah. I just do.
She's just in it for
the
fun.
She's naughty.
Yeah, Buzz, I'm going to believe you.
Yeah. I'm going to say
that's what
it's
I'm
not
believing.
Premeditated at all. She's just a girl that wants to have fun.
It's premeditated, but if you're going to do it like that, premeditated, just do it, honey. Just pose in one of these magazines. Just show your pink.
Yeah, but keep us posted.
It can happen.
In the new Penthouse. The very heterosexual Britney, meanwhile, reportedly plans to write a tell-all autobiography, including the details of her sex life.
Oh, my God. Like Justin was so small.
There is a picture of Britney Spears on the internet where she's in an evening gown, and she's wearing one of those low-cut, like low-cut, almost to nip-land. It was amazing.
Wow. Like, Justin, like, said that he wanted to do that, and I, like, said, like, how you, like you're hurting me when you're biting me there. Like,
and I
like,
said, like, Justin, that's where food comes out.
Like, don't bite. I wasn't even talking about that.
I was. But, I'm sorry.
Of course you were. Of course you were.
That's right. It was you and me. Like, and I said, like, Justin. John, you're my brother. Oh, my God.
Like, didn't I have sex with you on the Mickey Mouse Club? Like, you're my brother, and I'm your sister? Like, oh, my God.
The unauthorized biography. Well, her story will apparently include her time with Justin Timberlake, her time with Limp Bizkit's Fred Durst, and her 2.5-day marriage to Jason Alexander. and all those parties. It's being billed as a tale of, quote, love, lust, and sadness.
Wow.
A London paper says she's looking for a ghostwriter, naturally.
Ooh.
Color.
Dad, Brittany.
Color me and probably Mike disappointed.
Why?
Julia Roberts has tiny breasts, no butt, and is an ice queen in bed, according to an author who checked with her ex-lovers.
Rob, where's my horse sound effect? Come on, what are you doing? You're killing me.
Oh, and she bites her nails to the quick. James.
Ugly.
James Spada is coming out with a book called Julia, Her Life.
Not James Spader, the actor.
Not James Spader. This is James S-P-A-D-A. Spada.
Spada.
Mm-hmm.
Spada.
He was a whore.
He says he talked to Kiefer Sutherland, Dylan McDermott, Jason Patrick, Richard...
Next on Horseface.
Richard Gere.
Previously on Horseface.
And Matthew Perry. 24-star Kiefer Sutherland gets the credit for the comments about her breasts, her butt, her nails, and her iciness in bed. He thought he was talking confidentially to a friend. Jason Patrick called dating Julia the ultimate nightmare.
Wow.
Matthew Perry says he still finds her fascinating, but complains, quote, she's always borrowing money from me.
Wow.
I've never thought Julia Roberts was pretty.
Yeah, now you're in that exclusive club.
Yeah.
That's a good club to be in. I'll be in that club. I'll be in rehab if I'm in that club. If it's Kiefer Sutherland and Matthew Perry and me, I guarantee that ends up in a rehab clinic.
That's amazing, though. But I guess, Hollywood does nice things.
Yeah, I guess so.
Yeah, safer.
All right, I'll join the bandwagon then if all those guys hate her.
It's more Julia for me.
All right, good luck, Arsene.
Tony Soprano's shrink is taking it all off in Raleigh, North Carolina.
All the clothes?
Yeah, all the clothes.
The whole tray?
The whole tray. She's there playing Mrs. Robinson in the stage version of The Graduate.
Okay. Hi, Donna Mike. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Mrs. Robinson seduces a young man in that story. Lorraine Bracco says this about being naked on stage. Why not? This is why I got to choose a career to do those things and not feel guilty about it.
And you know what? You're not missing anything with her. She's one of the first ones I looked up on MrSkin.com.
Oh, really? Is she there? Yeah.
And I know there are a lot of skin aficionados out there. We've not had Jim Skin on the last couple of weeks because we've cut back a little bit in the mm-hmm. We have him on like once a month. I think we're having him on in a couple of days.
Good.
I know that Lorraine Bracco was a gal I had looked up on MrSkin.com.
Right.
Seen pictures of her naked and thought,
so.
Big deal, really. Yeah. Big deal. I mean, she's all fixed up on The Sopranos.
Well, I mean, have you seen recent nudes of her, Skin?
Yes, they are movies latest, really? The last 3 or 4 years that she's done where she's taken it all off.
Okay, well, you have through Sunday to catch her performance in Raleigh, North Carolina.
I'm going to go down to Raleigh and check out those cans.
Meanwhile.
Look at those great cans. She doesn't have great cans?
No, I'm afraid not.
Where's Anthony?
Anthony said, right here. You want to talk to him?
May I speak? Or James. I'm sorry, James.
James Gandolfini?
James Gandolfini.
All right. Hold on a second. I don't know why you always have to talk to him, for Christ's sake.
Hey, James.
Hi, how are you?
When's the show coming back on?
We'll be premiering in March and looking forward to a great run, and I recommend highly March 7th. Thank you, Robert.
Do you know Roy Black?
I do, quite well. Yeah.
Opinion of him?
Well, you might want to ask Tony about it.
Hey, Tony?
That. All right. He's eating right now.
Tony? Tony, what are you doing?
What do you want to know about?
What do you want to know?
What do you think about Roy Black?
Roy Black?
Yeah. He's a fag. Thank you.
Well, meet me at the intersection of Paris and Nicole, if only. Actually, there is now such an intersection, just not in the way I was hoping. It'll be in the town where they tape their first edition of The Simple Life. Altus, Arkansas. There was a ceremony unveiling the intersection of Paris Hilton Boulevard and Nicole Ritchie Avenue there this week. Just thought you'd like to know.
A big sinkhole.
I know you get. We're both thinking the same thing, though.
Rhymes with sinkhole.
But
still an entrance.
Well, you can say it's stinkhole.
Right.
A big stink pink hole?
Yeah, pink hole is what I was going to say. Yeah,
stink
hole.
Pink.
Well, because of Nicole Richie's liberal use of the F word on the Billboard Music Awards, the Fox TV network is now considering adding an incredible 5-minute delay to its live broadcast so it can more meticulously edit out profanity.
Don't let Infinity hear about that. I got news for you right now. The show that we're doing
right now,
we did it yesterday.
Sure.
They have us on a 24-hour delay.
It gets longer and longer. Yeah, it does. Most delays, not ours, are 10 seconds or less. requiring quick judgment on the censor's part. But the affiliates are demanding this longer delay, according to Broadcasting and Cable Magazine, a trade publication, quoting a Fox executive, no decision has been made.
Man. No, I'm not going to do it.
What?
You know, I'm just going to say that I was going to do it. I was just going to say, what the F is that about? And I'm not going to do that, because sometimes you just don't.
Don't do it.
Yeah. All right?
It's not the pro thing to do.
It isn't the pro thing, so I won't do it. I will be a pro.
Okay, thanks.
All right. There wouldn't be.
See, now you think I'm going to say it, but
no,
I'm not.
No, I really don't.
I'm not going to say it, but it'll
one
be
step ahead of you. I don't
it'll
think
be deleted
are.
Out.
Right.
I don't see the need now. If we were to say the F word now, our listeners wouldn't hear it.
Right.
No point.
There's no point in doing it.
But you know that we want to do it.
The censors are poor.
We both have, you know, because we have so much protection in that area. Right. It's fun occasionally, but it's almost good. Hi, we're back. Don. Incidentally, ladies and gentlemen, you didn't hear that, but Don did it.
Yeah.
Just in case you were wondering.
Loud and long.
Screamed it, too.
Yeah.
Screamed it twice, really as loud as I could.
Is there anything more fun?
Well, there wouldn't be a Letterman or a Conan if there hadn't been a Jack Parr, and today there is no Jack Parr. The man who pioneered the late-night talk show, the first host of the
Class
Show,
pure class,
died today at the age of 85. He started as a DJ.
He's the anti-Leno.
Yeah, he is,
my opinion.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he's dead. I don't care about him.
Well, do we link him with Keeshan?
I do.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
So Jack Parr. Got to be a third.
Yeah, and Ann Miller, and they're all in Bob Keeshan's pouch.
Joan Rivers. Yeah, you put Jack Parr in that category.
Yeah, he's a groundbreaker.
Mm-hmm.
They had to break.
I swear to God. You didn't even intend that to me.
Good.
That's funny.
Oh, my God.
Buzz, what's next here?
Doughy Al Franken body slams a guy.
Like physically?
Really, yes.
Really?
Cool.
Physically.
Who was he? Andy Rice?
You'll have to wait and find out.
That would be perfect.
Yeah, it would make sense.
Trying to think of anybody that Al Franken could body slam.
Andy Rice, and in the politics matchup.
Yeah.
Andy Rice, the guy who used to work here, goes number one sitting down,
carries a gun, and is a big right winger.
Right.
And Al Franken just threw him to the ground.
Yeah.
We'll be right back.
This is the Don and Mike Show. This is the Don and Mike Show.
Gosh, I hate to interrupt. It's all been so incredibly fascinating and entertaining and instructive. Really, the time has just flown by.
The Don and Mike Show. Can you believe we're back from commercials already?
Yeah.
Here's Don and Mike.
Tomorrow on the show, we're giving away the ultimate big game party six-pack. Do not say Super Bowl. Well, they wrote it right in front of me. A table for six in the ESPN Zone screening room where there's a 16-foot TV to watch the big game. Oh, I get it. Don't say.
Right.
Yeah, the big game.
Right. Dining with a dinner buffet and ESPN Zone game cards. Join our own Rob
Speedwagon.
He's going to be there. Yeah. He'll be there from 5 till 7 on Big Game Sunday.
So, Rob, you'll be leaving in the first quarter.
And the ESPN Zone in Washington. We'll give this away tomorrow.
You know, actually, Mike, I think I'm going to probably stick around and watch the whole game at the ESPN Zone. It is Big Game Sunday.
Thank you, Rob. I believe that.
Maybe even watch the post game.
There's the kickoff. Good night.
Now, what you do, though, is you tell your wife, you say, listen, do you remember that fight we had about the TV?
Yeah.
Look what Daddy's doing.
Yeah. Right.
Daddy's going down to be with the great unwashed.
To go pay for that television.
On Super Bowl Sunday. So I want to tell you, there's a lot of appearances that DJs don't like doing.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee being at a Super Bowl party is right up there with being at a New Year's Eve party.
Right.
That DJs don't want to be there because people get too hammered. People get too emotional.
Right.
People get, Rob, wait till they start coming up to you. Do you have We Will Rock You?
Yeah.
And that you're going to say, I'm not here to play records.
Well, F you.
I'm just here. And then that's when Rob will hear.
What are we talking about? It's going to be just fantastic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People should try to talk him into
it. And you're going to love being there.
Yes, there's a buffet.
Fantastic. What more do you need?
Exactly. Salads, burgers.
For Big Game Sunday.
Beer.
That's right. Don and Mike.
Do you have half-price burgers?
I believe the buffet is included when you get there.
I'm just kidding. I'm sorry. I'm not going to do that.
It's Big Game 38, don't you know? Isn't that still the dumbest thing?
It is.
That some companies, because they haven't paid for the right to say Super Bowl,
right?
Like this company we were just talking about, ESPN, they have to say big game.
Come out and enjoy the AFC-NFC championship game, XXXVIII.
The big game.
The big game.
It's huge.
It's big game Sunday.
Come out and see
the game.
Why do we have to say big? It goes without saying it's big. You simply say the game.
Ginormous game.
The game. That's it. Al Franken is a doughy build of a man, but he's scrappy. Yesterday, he body-slammed a protester in New Hampshire who was heckling Democratic presidential hopeful Howard Dean. Franken's thick-rimmed glasses were broken in the melee, but no one actually got hurt.
Al Franken is dead.
He is wrapped tight. Yeah, he's over the edge now. Quoting Franken, who says he's neutral between the Democrats, I got down low and took his legs out. I was a wrestler, so I used a wrestling move. The protester was a follower of the goofy radical fringe icon Lyndon LaRouche.
Mike talked about donating money to Wesley Clark. I can't tell you how many checks I've sent to Mr. Lyndon LaRouche.
Wow.
The next president of our United States. Ladies and gentlemen, Lyndon LaRouche.
And his supporters. They brought their own refrigerator boxes.
Hey.
I saw one. I swear to God. If he did not live in a refrigerator box, that was like a year ago.
Those people have names.
I know.
Those people.
Listen to this.
Those people. Those beautiful people like myself are ready for a new America.
I wish someday.
Lyndon LaRouche.
I strive. Each and every day I strive. And I hope that I can someday be able to even reach half your level of compassion.
Yeah, well, those people. I'm telling you, those people. Ordinarily, I'd spit on them as I drive by them, but I see, if they're in that box.
Somebody hands them the sign.
I know that.
You're with them.
They got a LaRouche for president. LaRouche in 2004.
There you go.
Right thinking of it.
Have you heard his commercial?
I've seen his commercial on TV.
The commercial is like, hi, this is Lyndon LaRouche.
Yeah, it's like Larry Bud Melman holding the microphone at the...
sitting in a Texaco restaurant.
At the New York terminal with Letterman, where whenever someone would come up to answer a question, he would hold the microphone away from them.
Hello, this is Lyndon LaRouche.
And then at the very end...
I approve this message.
Yeah, but that part at the very end is always overmodulated.
This is Lyndon LaRouche. I support this message.
The audio files. My God.
Wow.
But John Kerry is so very cosmetic. Among the slings and arrows he's dodging in the New Hampshire primary today is the accusation he got Botox injections to eliminate the many worry lines on his face.
Should have done something about that hair.
Botox
does have the helmet head.
Yeah. Botox is a poison that doctors inject to paralyze the face muscles.
George Michael.
I'm sorry, whenever you mention Botox, we have to mention George's name.
His wife makes no secret that she gets Botox injections, and a couple of newspapers have written that the candidate looks shinier than usual. But Kerry's campaign people say they're being attacked on cosmetics because their opponents cannot attack them on issues. They call this pathetic. Quoting a spokeswoman, have you looked at him? He looks like a 60-year-old man who's been working too hard.
Aren't they having that voting today?
Yeah, yes, they are.
Today is the New Hampshire primary.
Today is the voting.
Right, okay. We'll get it over with. You know, and then I don't want to wait for South Carolina.
You want the Democrats to declare a nominee based on New Hampshire?
Well, no, they can do the other states, too.
Okay.
Just get it done faster. And I'd say the same thing if it was the Republican.
Well, they got to get it done by the summer. And they are doing a little faster.
But it's January now, and the summer is, what, 6 months away?
It's a great process, but it's the Democratic system, Don.
Stinks. They should find the guy who they think can beat W.
Right.
They should all... I'm not saying that they will or won't, but just...
Right.
Get the guy. Who's the best guy? Why are we collectively wasting time and money going up to New Hampshire? I mean, let's be honest.
It's a tradition.
I know it's a tradition. Does anybody in this country really give an F about New Hampshire?
Well, no,
I know
no one does. Really.
I mean, they're part of America,
right.
Just like Hawaii is part of America.
Right.
But really, when we're shaping our opinions for the future,
right.
In any other, except maybe maple syrup, which is not even New Hampshire, that's Maine.
Yeah,
right?
They make a little maple syrup in New Hampshire.
Maybe that's where you'd go for an opinion.
Right. 85% of Americans surveyed today said that whatever happens in New Hampshire will in no way affect how they vote in the election.
Right.
Doesn't this primary system go back way hundreds of years, or at least over 100 years.
Yeah, boys, we're getting dangerously close to throwing out the democratic system of electing our president. So
right,
I warn you, we'll get a dictatorship, and we don't want to go that route. I, for one, love New Hampshire. All right, I'm a New Englander. Nothing wrong with it at all.
Some dictators build good roads, Mike.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you that we're on in New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Concord, New Hampshire.
Concord, New Hampshire.
Concord.
So do we have to vote?
No, Rob, because we're down here. We live down here.
How's WKXL. That? I want to tell you people.
Hello.
I think we could probably address all of our listeners individually by name on this.
I think it would be possible.
I think we've only got four or five people listening.
I tell you, New Hampshire's got one of the sexiest names.
Hold on, Mike.
Dixville Notch.
Hold on, what about, you ever heard of Keene, New Hampshire?
Keene, my buddy went to Keene State.
We're on there, too.
Keene, New Hampshire.
Mm-hmm.
I'd like to say hi to all the people at Keene State College.
Listen, you're great. Thanks for listening to the show.
Mm-hmm.
Big picture, you're irrelevant.
Keep the serum coming.
You don't matter.
Right. Not today, though.
You know what's better than you on any day except today? Arkansas.
Ooh.
Oh, no.
Wait.
No,
just a minute. I beg to differ.
Or, even worse, Alabama.
Ow. Oh, my God. You're losing your heads, fellas.
You never played the Rate the States game?
Rate the States? Oh, I give New Hampshire. New Hampshire's way up
there. New Hampshire ain't even top 25, baby.
I know we got
50 of them.
You ain't been there.
I beg to differ, my
You've
friend.
Been to New Hampshire?
I have been to New Hampshire when I worked in Rhode Island.
Rhode Island.
I went all the way up to New Hampshire, all the way up there.
What did you do it for?
What did I do it?
Yeah, why'd you
go
there?
To New Hampshire?
Campaigning?
Come on. Why'd you go up there?
To get high.
And then he drove back home.
Should have said leaf peeping. That's the truth. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I went up there to get high.
Had a friend, huh?
Yeah, had a friend.
You've got a friend in New Hampshire. That's a nice... Where's that Jersey? I forgot.
You've got a friend in... No, it's New Jersey and you perfect together.
Right. New Jersey and you perfect together.
You've got a friend in Pennsylvania.
New Hampshire, of course, is live free or die.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, which is on their license plate up there in the irrelevant state.
You will admit that it's pretty.
What, New Hampshire?
Yeah, it's beautiful.
Pretty irrelevant.
It would be...
Hey!
It would probably be in the top five prettiest states. Or top 25 prettiest states.
That's good for me.
But overall, it's in the bottom 25,
mm-hmm.
okay. state-wise.
And you know, listen, I'll tell you what, right now, I'll build the A-frame in New Hampshire. You can have yours in Alabama.
Okay. All right, you kind of beat me there. It's very rare when I give up on an argument. But, okay, you got me there.
Yes, thank you.
You got me there.
But in just a few more years, maybe we won't be... This past week, Bill Gates predicted the end of spam by two...
Tiny.
Not since he started getting emails.
It's Microsoftic.
Oh!
And the head of an anti-spam company agrees with Bill.
Head.
A new federal anti-spam law went into effect.
Nice head. Good head.
New law went into effect January 1st, and although the unwanted emails are still coming, they're not quite as fast and furious as they were over the holidays. Yes, I did.
And fast and furious and head.
As it stands now, 3 out of every 5 emails are spam. But anti-spam technology continues to advance.
Let's talk to Mr. Spam.
It just doesn't get any better than this.
He loves spam.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's Sam. I thought it was Spam Hub.
No,
it's Spam Hub.
Spam Hub. Him we want to keep. Speaking of Bill Gates, his company has taken a new approach to the young Canadian named Mike Rowe. Remember this story?
Right.
17-year-old Mike developed a website, which he cleverly named MikeRoveSoft.com.
Oh, I remember. This is a funny story.
Microsoft's overpaid lawyers were not amused and were all over the high school kid with paperwork.
Do we know if he's related to Debbie?
I don't
know. Debbie Rowe?
Right. That's a good question.
She's the one that Michael said. When we were playing the Rowe game yesterday, it was Rowe versus Wade.
Right.
And I was playing, I guess... Just in my own head. Mm-hmm. And row your boat.
Tommy Rowe, totally obscure.
No, I'm thinking that, though. Yeah. You're not thinking of the singer, somebody else?
I'm thinking about an actual, maybe the hockey player, but there is also a singer.
There's a Tommy Rowe that sang an awful dizzy.
Right.
I'm so dizzy. But there's not many other Rowes out there.
No, not many. Well, after all the bad PR, the computer giant tried a softer approach. They gave the boy an Xbox. They also bought his website name, and they're covering the cost of building a new website for the lad and redirecting traffic to it. They're also giving him Microsoft certification training since he's so bright and all. The company says it now thinks its first approach might have been a bit impersonal.
Hey, but wait, what did they pay for it?
Well, it, trade, nothing. It's theirs. I mean,
Mike,
nothing.
What we did was we gave the young man... Hi, it's Roy Black.
Hi, Roy. How are you?
What we did was we gave the young man the Xbox, which we got at cost. Then we are going to...
Thank you, Roy.
...hook him up with his own web server, his own site, which, of right. course, the cost is negligible.
Yes.
And we also gave him some of our games, which are overstocked.
Well, what did that really cost Microsoft, Roy?
Zero. My favorite number. I know you've heard that song,
yes.
One is the Loneliest Number.
Yes.
It truly is. Zero is my friend. Hi. It's Roy Black.
Congratulations, Roy. Albert Einstein married his first cousin. So did Charles Darwin.
Hey, so incest.
So did the Prophet Muhammad.
Right. Incest. Tomorrow we'll have the incest winner on the show incidentally.
Are we setting some kind of trend? And so did Jacob and Rachel in the Old Testament. But in the modern day U.S., it's still illegal to marry your cousin in most states. That notion that cousin marriages are inbreeding and produce defective offspring comes from long ago. But scientists now say that notion is incorrect.
Oh, Jesus.
A lot of kissing cousins plan to run with that information. They're now speaking out for their right to marry.
New Hampshire loves this.
Hey! Quoting one cousin in love, my parents raised me to go to the Bible with any question. To my surprise, God is okay with cousin marriage. And now, so are genetic scientists.
Well, that's good news for...
They say the 1958 research that led to our laws was completely and totally wrong. I'll have more tales of incest tomorrow.
And so will I. We'll pick the incest winner tomorrow. We have the five finalists.
Yeah, I look forward to my low-grade headache.
In sports, a new report says that over the next week, employers will waste $821 million on workers who are focusing on the Super Bowl instead of their jobs.
Amen.
The report says each fan spends an average of 10 minutes a day talking about the game.
I'll drink to that.
That 10 minutes is worth about $2.59 per worker. With over 130 million Americans working, well, it adds up. Even if not every worker is a football fan, 53 million Americans are, and, well, there's your $821 million.
And if you really want some fun, seriously, go to one of the sports books in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
Go to one of these websites, or simply call somebody up in Las Vegas. Hey, we can discuss this maybe tomorrow on the show. We're almost out of time. Again, the crazy list of things that you can bet on.
Oh, yeah, the way that the British
the British started that. And we
it's,
on this
it's the best this year. The thing is, who will score more? The combined Panthers and Patriots score or LeBron James that night?
Yep.
Who will be the first player to score a point? You can even bet on who will win the coin toss.
And they've got it figured out where the odds, they really do have odds on this.
Yes, they do.
That's
and,
great.
For instance, if the Panthers win the coin toss, you can go past that whole thing and say, okay, Panthers win.
Right.
Which end zone will they kick the ball out of?
Right.
You can bet on
Didn't
that.
Didn't we bet on something like that last year?
Yeah.
I know I bet on a coin toss last year.
We gave a guy in Reno $100 to bet on.
I want to do that again. I want to do that again tomorrow.
On somebody scoring the first touchdown or something like something ridiculous like
well,
that.
Well, if he's out there, call us tomorrow. Let's do it again. Finally, a woman who delivers mail in rural England is back at work now after some time off to recover from the trauma.
There she is.
She was trying to open a mail slot, and it wasn't cooperating. She couldn't understand why this one wouldn't open. She tried to peek inside. She could see that something was blocking the slot, but she couldn't make out what it was. So she stuck her fingers inside and touched it. Then she knew what it was.
What was it, Buzz?
The penis. It belongs to 16-year-old Matt Riley, who's since been arrested for public indecency.
Bacardi Limon.
He's been ordered to pay the postal worker £100 and to stay out of trouble for the next 6 months.
So wait, the guy was in a...
He put his thing in the mail slot so that when the mail lady would reach in...
Like in Porky's.
Yeah.
Okay, I got
it. Post this. I'm Buzz Burbank on the Don and Mike Show.
Thank you, Buzz.
Yeah.
That's it. We will see ye tomorrow with the all-new episode. Good day to you, sir.
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 Buzz, don't forget, tomorrow's show starts, as always, 3 p.m. local time.
Not 3:03?
3 p.m. local
okay.
time.
Okay.
Hey, you.
Wheels are turning.
Good luck tonight with the missus. Okay. P.M. Eaters.
Can we meet again? Sammy Davis Jr. saying, be kind, be nice, and I hope the next performer has the pleasure of having as nice an audience as you've been tonight. And let me leave you swinging.
This is the Don and Mike Show.
Don and Mike, WKFJ.
For over 20. 12 years. This is the exclusive home of the Don and Mike Show.